What you're about to listen to is part of the Podgods Network. If you go to podgodsnetwork.com, you'll find other great shows there too. If you have a problem with this or any other show, please write us in an email. And go fuck yourself. Have a nice day!
All right, you primitive screwheads, listen up!
But more of the R-rated film that most other people do. There's some salty language in it and shit like that.
We work very well together, okay?
But it's gruesome twosome!
Gruesome twosome!
Pardon my French, but you're an asshole!
These guys are 11.
I'm here for the gangbang.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass.
Inconceivable!
And I'm all out of bubblegum.
Oh, no, not the beast!
Ah! I feel like I'm taking crazy pills!
What? Say what again? Say what again? I dare you! I double dare you, motherfucker! Say what one more goddamn time!
They've done studies, you know. 60% of the time, it works every time.
That doesn't make sense.
Set no substitutes.
Hey, enthusiast, this is Salty Language, episode 175.
Goddamn sexiest podcast on the network, Brian.
Undisputed sexiest podcast on the network.
And world even, reigning.
Because the reigning, defending, undisputed. I'm going to pull the Paul Heyman speech out there.
Nice.
Because if anyone disputes it, we just ignore them. So,
exactly.
So in our heads, doesn't
Block.
Exist.
Yep.
Block. Like wagging my finger like I'm Dikembe Mutombo afterwards.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Not so fast.
I'll be doing three snaps in a Z formation.
As is tradition.
It's true.
Oh, man. Yeah, so this is Salty Language episode 175 against the sexiest podcast in the network. I'm Brian, and the other guy is Rasputin.
Hello there.
Oh, wait, this works great as a, you know, sight gag.
Yes.
Well, you can tell by watching the YouTube channel. That we don't have active live anyway. I mean, there is a YouTube channel for the Salty Language podcast.
There is.
Which has got, you know, Tony put up the sexiest best of on the network on there.
God damn it. That's what I need to call it. The sexiest.
Just
best
any
of.
Bit that we do, it's just got to be the sexiest and then whatever the
fill
bit
in
name
the
is.
Blank.
Right. Yeah. Like the sexiest proctology exam ever. There
well,
it is.
Yeah. Doctor comes in, there's like candles and incense.
Well, naturally, we're not animals. You need, you know, you gotta have something to help you relax, you know.
It's true.
He's like, well, first I'm gonna put this tester finger in there to like, whoa, time out. Like, realize that the doctor's just trying new anal plugs on you.
Like, Jesus, can I finish my chamomile tea? Love of God.
Like, what is this, Hobo Canyon, the dude ranch Brian talked about?
Ah, Hobo Canyon. What can't you do besides wash and keep your teeth?
Be talked about openly at workplaces.
Also true.
What happens at Hobo Canyon stays at Hobo Canyon.
Yeah, well, except for the STDs.
Well, hey, listen.
Those wander out.
Listen, it is the wild. I mean, you know, what do you want?
Why are we talking about Hobo Canyon?
Because I had it written down to bring up.
Okay.
And I wanted to do a callback to last week's hobo palooza that it was.
Boy, was it.
Yeah. Ooh. Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah. So we just had Thanksgiving.
We did.
Did you make an absolute monster out of yourself?
I had two different Thanksgivings. Mm-hmm. Thank God they were separated by like 4 days.
Was either of them at Hobo Canyon?
No.
No? So no dusty trail eating?
No.
I found a rock.
Yeah, it was weird because, yeah, I had my mom's, which was like traditional.
Who didn't, know, right?
Hilarious.
Hey-o!
No, it was like traditional Thanksgiving with your turkey and your ham and all your mashed and all that, you know.
Right, and some pilgrims and Indians and such.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You know,
for the atrocities after dinner.
Yeah, syphilis, diphtheria, the whole works.
Right.
And then we had the in-laws on actual Thanksgiving, which was like, you know, there's turkey, but there's no mash, no gravy.
What?
Which is like, the fuck?
How do you
But then there's
have...
all the Polish food, all the kielbasa
and
all that.
Oh, okay, that's right. I wasn't thinking about that. Why have the turkey then?
I don't know, because I'm like, I mean, I'm a big, huge, I love turkey.
Right, but you love some kielbasa.
Well, yeah. Well, you should see my second meat plate. So it was ridiculous. I'm like, you know, the tip of the spear was vegetables and stuff.
Right. Like, you just got some on your fork.
Yeah.
And like, stab it into the veggies with the fork, and the rest is just meat.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
That sounds about right.
But yeah.
So you ate a plate of dicks. Gotcha.
I threw a beating on myself both days.
Yeah. Yeah, I imagine so. I tried to be good yesterday at my family's whatnot. So, and I only left there mildly guilty. So, I think I did a good job of it.
That's average. That's good.
Yeah, because I just really don't want to do that to myself anymore.
It's brutal.
Well, again, it's like I said, you know, my family's like, everything is like carbed. I mean, there's no just vegetable, you know, like it's green bean casserole. And mashed potatoes is as close as you're going to get to actual just vegetable.
Right.
You know,
right.
And that's not too far off, except that I found out later that it's got like beef stock, garlic, or garlic butter, and I'm trying to think what else was used in it. So it's not entirely just potatoes and milk or something, but you know, like the sweet potatoes are like almost candied, you know. And
oh yeah, yeah.
I mean, I made the green bean casserole and turned out pretty good and all, but
dude, I'm thinking about mashed potatoes with bacon fat. Yeah.
That seems like a great and terrible idea at the same time. You going to put some bacon in it, too? Why not, right? Yeah, all right.
Yeah, where am I going to get the bacon fat from, right?
Good enough. Well, yeah, you can't just make up all that bacon and be like, what am I going to do with this?
Exactly.
I mean, you can only rub so much of it on yourself.
For sure.
Right. That's where you get the bacon fat. You just squeeze out the chest hair. You're like, look, I'm a Greek.
Walking through the kitchen just glistening.
Like Neil?
Yeah, yes, there he is.
Shout out to the Daft Pod.
But it was, you know.
Well, there's a little difference, though, because it would be glistening chest hair. With him, it would be his boyish pecs.
Well, there you go.
And by boyish, I don't mean he isn't, like, ripped or anything. I'm just saying that, you know, he's hairless. So I just picture him as some kid from Tijuana.
I just stepped off some sort of barge in the Mediterranean.
True enough, yeah. you were basically like, you know, like on the Matrix, they're in those fluid sacks.
Oh, right.
At what point you're in one of those, but it's actually just a giant olive oil bottle.
Perfect. Beard oil.
Right.
Because I'm a gentleman.
Right.
Got to keep my beard healthy.
They finally let you out, and the light's just glinting off of everything.
Like, is that Silver Surfer? Who is that?
Wagging your beard in the breeze.
Of course. Power cosmic.
Naturally, ladies are just throwing themselves at your legs like it's a Frazetta painting.
Perfect. Now we're talking.
Yeah. If I could get over the dry heaving, this would be something to art up.
Just have to find a Frazetta painting, put my face on it.
Well, like I said, I'd still got to get over the dry heaving. Frazetta, I like Frazetta, but I don't want to stare at your mug. I mean, hey, how's it going?
No, you know how everyone in Toledo's like, oh my gosh, Schmucker's pie.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. For those not in the know, Schmucker's is like a little shitty shithole of a place.
Tony's not in any way foreshadowing here. No.
That if you look online, places to like eat when you're coming through Toledo, everyone puts Schmucker's for the pie.
Right.
So my mom's
saying, this has nothing to do with the jelly company or whatever. Smucker's.
No, not Smucker's.
Yeah.
Schmucker's.
Yeah.
So dude for my mom's thing shows up with two pumpkin pies. And if you know anything about me, Brian, fucking, I could throw down on some pumpkin pie.
Right. After you've had sex with it.
Well, got to dominate it first. Right. Show it to his boss.
Right. Duh. Fresh whip topping. Right.
So I sit down with this piece of pumpkin pie.
Right.
The goddamn thing tasted like dirt. It was
really?
Horrible.
Yeah.
It was terrible. And I don't know if it's because I've been spoiled, because, yes, you know, wife makes...
I'm just going to answer you right there, yes.
Probably right.
You didn't even have to finish that sentence. Maybe for the listeners, but not for me. Or for Neil's people. Neil, here's a free term for you, another one. Glisteners. Anyway.
That's a good one. The Glisteners.
The Daft Pod Glisteners. It sounds like a dance crew.
It does. We're Daft Pod. These are Glisteners.
He's got like the Nitro Girls, but they dance. Like they do an intermission on the show, and they come into the room on the YouTubes, and they just dance until they come back from the bathroom or whatever.
It's a great idea.
I know, right? Damn it, I should cut this out and just use it for us. We need dancers.
We do need dancing girls.
No, we don't. We bring plenty of sexy. We don't need sexy dancing girls. We're the WWE in this. Right?
Good point.
Right?
Yes.
All right.
Right.
We're the Attitude Era.
But yeah, it must be that I've been spoiled by actual pumpkin pie that my wife provides.
Yeah.
You know, although they had a pumpkin pie from, of all places, Costco at Jeannie's parents.
Yeah.
And it was phenomenal.
I'll tell you, I've had a few variety of baked goods from the Costco's, and most of it's decent. It's at least pretty good. It's, you know, some of, I mean, again, if you were like Costco pumpkin pie or Jeannie's pumpkin pie, well, someone else is going to get the Costco one. But
yeah, for sure. I mean, it was like, she's like, oh, we should share a piece of pie. I'm like, okay, and I brought two pieces of pie.
Well, right. No, see, what you should have done would just been like, on yours, and then reach over and just start eating hers and be like, what, that's you said we were going to share?
That's basically what happened.
Right.
Because I ate my pie, and she's like, you know, I really only wanted a bite. So she handed it to me to set it on the end table next to me, and I just ate it.
Well, why would you set it on the end table? There's pie.
Well, because she was going to eat it later.
Oh.
I didn't know that. I just ate it.
No, see, it doesn't
and
work
I felt
that
like
way.
Hot shit after that.
There's pie in the vicinity. You have to, needs to be.
I mean, I brought growlers full of fluids there, and, you know.
Left with some full of fluids.
Yeah. I really consumed way too much food yesterday.
That's fine.
It's all right. I don't throw down a good old fashioned glutton fest that often. So
right. What'd you see? I posted on the Instagrams where I was like, you know, here's our everyone's selfie for later, and it's I can't think of the guy's name from Life of Brian or Meaning of Life. I'm sorry,
History of the World.
Is that I thought it was Meaning of Life?
Meaning of Life.
Okay,
you're right. Fuck off, I'm full.
And then he just explodes.
Whatever his character, John Cleese was the guy who played the part, but. I know, he was the waiter. John Cleese is the waiter.
I just love the picture of him where he's just got food all over his face and his suit and everything.
And he's got his throw-up bucket.
Yeah, that's normal.
Oh, what a disgusting skit.
That's how I used to get prepared for Thanksgiving, but no longer. Just can't do it anymore. Well, I can. I just don't want to do it anymore. I'd rather eat like that twice in a day. You know, like go eat a good amount of food twice in that day than one time make a complete monster out of myself.
Oh, believe me, I was watching other people with, like, the commoner plate was, like, heaping.
Right.
Like, what are, you know, I do, like, a, you know, a little single layer, and I go back and get some other stuff, and except for meat plate. That was just
well,
obscene.
Well, meat plate doesn't count. That's just fuel right there, you know?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that's just protein.
Right. Right. That's just you satisfying a lust. That's all that is. Let's be honest. That's just your sexy time for the day. Rubbing it on your face.
Dude, it's kielbasa. Come on, it's amazing. Right? So yeah, how was your Thanksgiving festivities?
That was about it though. That's just that. That's the way it was all spread out. We kind of me and show sat out on their like patio things. They have a TV out there, so we were sitting out there watching the footballs.
Right.
So it was also right by the food, which is, you know, also extra amazing that I didn't make a complete glutton of myself, considering all the food was within arm's reach.
Oh, that would have been a problem.
Yeah. It wasn't, though. I was behaving myself. It probably helps, too, that I haven't been feeling like 100% the last few days because of some sinus whatnot and things. So, you know, as you're a little sick, you're like, I don't know.
Yeah, for sure.
So that's probably for the best. Indeed.
Oh, excuse me. Anything else in your week?
Well, you know, I've been posting various stuffs about, you know, dealing with the withdrawals from the antidepressant and stuff.
Right.
And
have you tried drinking?
No, actually, I haven't had a drop in this time.
Really?
Yeah, I'm on day 11, I believe it is, with no effects or in me, and you know, no alcohol or anything like that. So
I've been real tempted.
Yeah, I've been really tempted, but it's just like I kind of want to know what's going on in my head so that, you know, I can act accordingly. Because I've pretty much been drunk this whole time because of the effects of it.
Fair enough.
Because I've been kind of dizzy. You know, my mind's just a little fuzzy. I'm not as sharp as I normally am, you know. So it's kind of felt like I've got a good buzz going on, except I didn't get to drink any of the delicious alcohol.
Well, just fair warning, I made a certain promise to a certain Jessica at a brewery we know that we'd all show up at some point.
Well,
What am I, a
monster? I can't go, you know.
Yeah. So I went to go fill my growlers. She was working, so she's like, oh, my God, it's been so long.
Yeah, I know. You saw her blonde hair, right?
Yeah.
Holy Jesus.
She's like, I dyed my hair.
Like, really? Do you think? Yeah. I didn't even notice. A pixie-like girl with, you know, hair a flutter down her back. And, oh, no, I didn't even notice. It's bright blonde instead of dark, dark brown.
Yeah, exactly. Who knew?
Like, you understand you're a pretty female and I'm a guy, right? Of course I noticed.
Yeah, I noticed everything. We're supposed to make an appearance at some point down there.
That's fine.
Fair warning.
Oh, that's fine.
Yeah.
I fully intend to. Yeah, I was talking with our pal Jeremy the other day, and him and I came to the agreement of, he said his winter break is coming up before long with school and stuff.
Right.
So he's like, a drinking night needs to be had, and I'm like, damn right it does. So, yeah, I'm pretty sure we're all feeling that it's on before long.
Excellent.
We're going to have a let's make a mess of ourselves kind of night.
Ugh, hopefully it's not on a weekday.
Weekday it is, got it.
A-boo. A-boo.
Everyone loves it. Let's see. What was I saying here? Oh, I ran out of my blood pressure medicine this week, which, let me tell you, pairs real well when you lose your antidepressant, because that keeps you from kind of going really low.
Right.
The blood pressure thing kind of helps you keep from feeling like everything's going aah! In your head. So when you lose both, it's kind of fun because you kind of just slingshot all over the place. You know?
Oh, that sounds exciting.
That was a lot of fun. I finally got some more of that today to... straighten that out, hopefully.
Right.
Because that's not been fun. Another reason, you know, for the no drinking is, you know, with no blood pressure medicine, it's probably a bad idea to be drinking.
Nah, I'm sure it'll be fine.
You're right. Like, what was his cause of death? Too much bourbon. He had a stroke.
Ah, bourbon stroke strikes again.
Like, eh, it's a good way to go.
It would be a good way to go.
Yeah, I want to kind of cap off like the whole withdrawal thing, and for anybody who's interested, it's still, I like I said, I'm 11 days in and it's still fucking with me pretty good,
right?
So there's parts of it have gotten better, but a lot of it is still whatever. Like the dreams are just the fucked up part. Like I keep waking up, and like last night there was something, I woke up and I was just like, I sat up and was just started reaching for something. I have no idea what I was reaching for. But whatever it was in that dream, I was trying to reach for it, and I sat up awake trying to reach for it, and then was frustrated because I couldn't remember what I was trying to get.
That would be frustrating.
And it's like, you know, if you wake up from sleep and you're like, oh, why was I reaching for something? You generally just be like, oh, I was dreaming. But it just felt so damn real that, and again, this isn't like a one-off kind of thing. It's like every dream that I have is this way, you know?
Right.
So
yeah.
Fucking weird. Like last night, actually, I woke up like gasping. At one point, and I went back to sleep, and I woke up basically just, like, out of my mind, like, almost terrified, because I kept falling asleep and having this dream that I was dying.
That's nice.
It pictured Groundhog Day, except that you're just dying every time, and I had that, like, four or five times last night. It was fantastic.
Now, to be fair, in Groundhog Day, he did die every time, but he also learned how to, like, play the piano.
Yeah, but see, I'm not
French.
I didn't learn anything in this.
No.
So, and I really have zero interest in Andy McDowell. So, you know, that was really the reason he was learning.
Wait, what about for the story?
Bill Murray slappy seconds. I mean, I guess. Or did you mean just tagging Andy McDowell as the story?
Just for the story.
Oh, I thought that me and Bill Murray being Eskimo brothers was the story.
That would be good too.
Yeah, because then we'd be in the EBDB, whatever. I forgot what it is on the league.
Like, you guys got an Andy McDowell wobbly H going, and he
right.
just goes, no one's ever going to believe you.
I'm like, you are correct, sir. And he's like, it's doctor. And you're right. Yeah, so there's that. And one last thing on this whole thing is thanks to folks who've, you know, sent me good wishes and, you know, whatnot for along the way. And for a few that have, you know, again, people have reached out to me asking me questions or kind of like, you know, told me that us talking about this or whatever on the show is refreshing because, you know, it's still a topic that's not full on, you know, assaulted by a lot of people.
Someone felt refreshed by our show.
Well, naturally, after you get off, don't you feel refreshed? Sexiest pot in the... Anyway.
That's true.
Yeah. But no, that it was, you know, like I said, it was different that other shows don't... Or not other shows, but it's just a lot of things just still don't talk about this. So,
right.
Good on you. Keep fighting the fight, y'all.
Because we bring the real subjects.
Yeah,
it's
we
like
do.
The real world. Real world, the pot. I can't talk.
I can't stop. Either. I know, we're a damn mess. We keeps it reels. Real dumb.
Wheels?
Yeah. We keep it wheels? Are we segueing to talking about The Flash?
Nice.
All right. So, you got anything else for the week? That's about all I got.
Oh, my friend. We had Festivale.
I wasn't there, so it didn't happen. Oh.
Well, you need to come next year because it was a good time.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was up in Ferndale, which is actually, it's like an awesome little part of Detroit.
Yeah.
It's a really cool little city.
Yeah, from the pictures that you posted, it looked like you guys had a good time. I couldn't help but notice that the pictures were only half as sexy as they could have been, though.
Well, yeah, naturally.
But aside from that, yeah.
But, yeah, it was, I mean, they had...
Well, let me rephrase. I can't say half because that's almost like saying that Jeannie and T couldn't bring any sexy to the table, and I don't want to quite put it that way. I mean, they brought, you know, a little to the table.
That's just not as...
Right, right.
It's not full value.
Right, it's not as electrifying as if I was there.
It's not a double barrel shotgun blast of sexy.
Yeah, that is exactly how I describe myself. Oddly enough, women are frightened of me. My porn career didn't last long.
They had like some good bands and real good. The food was awesome.
Now, what did you get? I know it was like, what, $30 to get in?
It was $30 to get in. You got like three tickets, which are good for probably about three times the amount you get at Beer Fest of beer.
So about 9 ounces, 10 ounces of beer,
probably?
Yeah,
something like that.
Okay.
Or food.
Oh, okay. So you could get food instead then. Okay.
Right.
Because I was wondering about that because I'm like, man, it kind of stinks that. But I was like, well, at Beer Fest, you didn't get any food. You had to pay for it. So.
Yeah. And then it was like we paid we got like 8 tokens for, I think, another $30 or something like that.
Right.
So, you know, and then we divvied those up and whatever. But yeah.
Right. One to T and the rest of you guys.
No, dude, the food was killer. They had this like 4-foot in diameter frying pan over coals, making like potatoes in it. It was,
That's interesting.
And these boxes I want to buy called like roasting boxes. It's a grill on top and you open it up and you can put animals inside and roast them.
Nice.
Dude.
I like that you said.
I looked them up online. I had to.
I like that you said animals inside. Now, out of curiosity, when you looked them up, did you look them up on Amazon.com?
You betcha.
After going to the Salty Language website, of course.
Well, when I buy it, of course.
Right. Well, just in case, you know, you should always just go there wow. Totally lost it.
Habit.
Yes.
That's
it. That is exactly the word I was looking for. Yeah.
Yeah, your Amazon protocol should be Salty Language.
Right.
Yeah.
Clicking on that link to help us out, bring all the sexies to the podcast. I guess that's the only way you could stop us.
Right. The only thing that they didn't do right, though, is it was laid out real shittily. Because they had this enormous beer tent with the band, the like stage inside.
Yeah.
And then probably 20 feet across from the opening of that tent was the beer tents. Mm. So everyone's lining up for the beer, and you couldn't move through that area.
Yeah, that's annoying.
Yeah, it was like, it's not a good layout.
Right. Now, out of curiosity, like, because when we went to Beer Fest, there was, I don't know, hundreds of breweries there. So each one had a small line, but generally no more than, what, 5 people at most, you know?
Right.
Now,
these lines were huge.
Were there less brewers at this?
Yeah. Well, they had a tent that was like these are beers we're serving all day.
Okay.
And it was like, you know, all Michigan breweries pretty much.
Right.
Right. And then they had a tent of like, hey, at 6 o'clock, we're tapping this keg.
Oh,
and
God.
It's here until it's gone.
Oh, that's horrible because there's going to be people just rushing over for that.
Yeah. And it was all like Belgium ales and Christmas beers.
So I would have been like, and stayed in the other one. But
some of the stuff I got in that tent was awesome.
I'm just not a fan of a lot of the Christmas beer. I just don't like spicy beers, and that's the way a lot of them, it's just too much of that. It feels
winter
like
warmers and stuff like
that. Yeah, a lot of them feel like they just soaked a Christmas tree in coffee and then like you know, put it in a bottle, you know? It's not even a Christmas tree I flung around with my powers, you know?
Probably the best beer we had was, T got it from Founders. It's Dirty Bastard. That was really good. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. It seems like I've heard of that. Has that been out?
I think so.
Okay.
I had never had it before, though. It was at least not in my Untapped. I may have had it if I was too drunk to put it in, but...
Yeah, what? That never happens. Whenever you're being an enthusiast, you're constantly... about your faculties.
The highlight, besides potatoes and the food and beer.
And the kids' magazine, right?
Was the, well, of course, was one of the food things you could get was donuts. And they had a deep fryer, and they're just like fresh from the fryer, shake them in salt and cinnamon, or salt, sugar and cinnamon, hand them over.
I was kind of wondering about that when you said salt. I was like, that's different.
Dude, the donuts were...
Just straight out, like no dipping anything, just... Here's
just hot, fresh donuts with sugar and cinnamon on them.
Right.
And to pull they were off the chain.
Nice. Did you call the people making them like the mayor of Flavortown or anything?
You know, I should have because I walked away because they had to wait so long because they fried them right there for you.
Right.
You know?
But that's worth waiting for, though.
Yeah.
Because the difference between a hot, fresh donut and like one that's been sitting for 10 minutes is that's a pretty wide gap.
It's true.
You know, that's why it's, you know, I've had like beignets up here and stuff before. And it's like, I want to get them in like New Orleans at some point, you know, where they're from, you know.
Right.
I want to go get like real ones, not ones that are what someone else is calling them. It's like, no, this is a donut. Stop your filthy lying.
I also had a conversation with a guy outside of the Pissers.
Uh-huh. You'll do that. And
Because he was dressed up as Mick Giblets from the league.
All right, then.
Because I'm like, dude, you got a piss flap in that? It's like, oh, yeah, my wife put one in for
me. Nice, nice. Or what was it? The hell was it that we called it 2 weeks ago for Iron Man's costume? The,
butt flap codpiece.
Yeah, there you go.
Yes.
Trademark.
Yeah, so I'm pretty sure we're going to try to go next year. It was a good time.
Right.
A lot of fun.
Do they only do a once-a-year event, or do they have a summer and winter?
I don't know, because that was the second time they've done it.
Oh, okay. So they're still new on the scene. Yeah. And the other one.
I think they are dealt with growing pains this year. That's why I think it was laid out so
well. I imagine that would make sense, because there's so many freaking breweries in Michigan, and these beer fests are really becoming like cult events. You know,
well, did you hear that Budweiser officially got outsold by craft beer finally?
No, but I'm not surprised on that for two reasons. One, craft beer is all the shit right now. And two, when Budweiser sold to that German company or whatever, I'm sure there were a lot of Americans that were like, fuck them krauts and
the fucking Nazis making my beer.
Yep.
I want me American beer. Coors! What they don't know is the American standard beer is American. It's the king. Meanwhile, beer came from Germany. Well, not came from, but was heavily refined.
And also, it's not like Budweiser tastes any different than it did, but whatever.
It just tastes... Ugh.
All it is now, there's just better options.
Yeah.
A lot of people are realizing that there's just better beer. And don't get me wrong, I'll still drink a Budweiser if one's put in front of me, but I'm not going out of my way to buy it unless money is an option. Or if money's an issue, maybe.
Right.
Because, you know, I mean, I can get a whole lot more Budweisers than I can get of, hell, even Yingling. You know what I mean? And Yingling's not really a craft beer. It's still a bigger whatever, but it's still pricier, you know?
Yeah.
And then if I'm going into, like, the microbrews where it's like, well, Blitzen is, like, $10.99 for a six-pack.
Right.
You know? And I like Blitzen, but that's $11 for a six-pack. And if I'm looking to get drunk, I don't know if that's getting it done unless I do it fast.
Right. So. Yeah, Blitzen's pretty high octane. I think it's like 7% or something.
It is. It's actually more than I don't think I could drink. Personally, I don't think I could drink a six of it. It's too much spice for my
delicate palate. I say, I've killed a growler of it in a night before.
Yeah, well, I've killed a growler of things before, too. Mine was the bourbon barrel ale.
Right.
Where I killed that in a little more.
When I filled my growlers, because for some reason, the hostess at the Oliver House that's always there, she didn't seat me in... Our one, you know, in someone I know's section. She sees me in some random bald dude section.
Well, you need to remedy that by asking for the people working.
Well, I figured, you know, because she's like, oh, wow, it's been a long time since I've been here.
You know what that was? She punished you.
I think so.
She was like, we're going to put you in the worst section in here.
Pretty much. But it was supposed to be like Jeannie and I and the kids are going to go, you know?
Yeah.
And I was kind of like, it might be a bad idea because day before Thanksgiving is the busiest bar night in America.
Absolutely.
So I was like,
yeah,
it might be crazy.
Holy jeebus, going around here. Like, Tuesday night, I was going out, and me and Jen were going to go get dinner. We went up to Nick and Jimmy's, you know, place right up the street here. That place was, and you and I have been there on Tuesdays. Yeah. Deadsville. Dude, that place was full up. There was nowhere to park on Tuesday.
Right.
You know, and then last night, or Wednesday night, I mean, I was out with show, and as we were going around places around here, you know, that are bars, just full up.
Just packed, right?
Yeah, Sidelines was full up. Nick and Jimmy's was full up. Trying to think where there was another place right around here. Can't remember what it is. Anyway, there were three places that I saw, and I'm like, holy shit, these places are full. Oh, no, it was, we were over on Monroe Street, Bar 145.
Oh, well, and that place is always busy.
Not always. Like, I've been through there a couple times during the week, and they're like, eh, business-wise, but they were crushed. I mean, they had people standing outside waiting.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, I've never seen anyone outside waiting on a Wednesday at that place.
Right.
You know what I mean? And again, I know it's a busy bar night, because everyone's like, oh, I'm off tomorrow, whatever. But, wow. Like, hey, cool, you know, good for the businesses.
Right.
Because I like it when I see a place like that full up, because, and Nick and Jimmy's and, you know, the smaller places, the local places, because that means they'll stay open.
Oh, you know, support local. Keep the money within the system, right?
Yeah, which is another reason to buy craft brew.
Exactly.
Yep. Because, again,
keep the money local.
Your money going to
buy. But, yeah, so there was me looking like dad of the year walking into the Oliver House, although it was dead.
Huh.
But I got my two kids and my three growlers. The fill.
I don't see a problem with this. As long as you remember to take those same numbers out.
Yes.
Like, if you leave with the three growlers and one or no children.
Or even worse, just two children.
Yeah. Yeah, not even yours. You're like, I like these two better. They, like, here, come here for a hug. Like, yeah, they look better with me.
No, I'm talking about forgetting the growlers. That'd
be correct. Oh, right.
No, but I sat down at the table and lined up my growlers, and the guy walks over. He's like, oh, I see this isn't your first rodeo.
Aww.
I was like, dude, you have no idea. And that's when Jessica came over. We started bullshitting.
You
should have
just crushed him in the groin with one of those growlers.
I wanted to. I was so annoyed that I had some random dude.
When she came over, you should have been like, can I go sit in your section?
Yeah, I know. I should have. I was just kind of thrown off completely.
Can we pretend this guy doesn't exist? Because this reminds me of other times we've been here, and it didn't end up well. It ended up with, like, Brian getting a French fry in his beer.
Yeah. Yes, exactly.
Two French fries in his beer. I mean,
two French fries. Ah, fry beer.
Yeah. And that was before I used to, you know, just put the straw in the pitcher and drink. good times.
Ah, shite.
We drink. We're stupid.
Yeah, you'll have it.
Not that it's going to stop anytime soon. Well, I guess it kind of has for me, but whatever.
Ah, you'll be fine.
It's just a temporary hiatus. That's all it is. Anyone who knows me knows that. I've never gone that long without having something to drink. Especially this time of year, because I do like blitzing, and, you know, it's not like I can get that in July, you know?
Yeah, it kind of runs out pretty quick.
Yeah, so if there is any winter beers that I like, I, you know, will especially go that route.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, I do have something I need to, that's what I'm looking for, admit.
Oh, boy.
Yep.
This isn't nudity at the beer fest, is it?
No.
Oh, okay.
It was way too cold for that.
But, right. Like, your balls were behind your eyes. That's how far up they crawled.
Yeah, pretty much. but and they say the first step to having a problem is admitting it, right?
Sure.
Sure. So, Brian, I hate to say this, but joined Pinterest.
What?
And I kind of like it.
Damn it.
And I fully expect to take shit. But here's why. I was looking up. What the fuck was I looking up? Oh, something
how to
about,
be a sissy pants and get on Pinterest.
Pretty much. It was something I wanted to, like.
I've forgotten that I have a full-length beard and I want to go up.
Yeah. But it was something I wanted to, like, build. It was something we saw. We went to something downtown called the Maker's Market. I keep wanting to call it Maker's Mark.
Right, yeah, I know, right? It's all, like, local crafty stuff,
like,
and whatnot.
Local crafty.
Yeah.
And it used to be, like, the Turkish Bazaar in the Warehouse District.
That
we
sounds
went
a lot seamier than...
I know. Yeah. I always liked it. They called it the Turkish Bazaar.
Right.
So I kind of was hoping I could pick up, like, Russian women or something.
Right, or three penis wine or something, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. But this place was, I couldn't believe the amount of people that were in there, like vendors. It was packed.
Well, it's good.
Cool.
That's very cool, because I think almost everybody in there is generally local.
Yeah, but I mean, like, even people from, like, Cleveland were in there. Some dudes out of Detroit were in there.
Huh.
It was wild.
There was a lot of knitting, wasn't there?
A lot of what?
Knitting.
Yeah, yes.
Yeah.
A lot of beard stuff. I bought more beard oil from some guys I've never seen.
Well, that's dangerous, especially if it used to be a Turkish bazaar.
Yeah.
You don't know. Yeah.
Stuff smelled delicious, and the guys were awesome, so what are you going to do?
Fair enough. Not good enough to get a shout-out, though, huh?
It's a Detroit Grooming Company, I think it's called.
I was just fucking around, yeah.
Yeah.
I was like, I don't even know if you've had time to use it yet, you know.
No, first application today.
Well, because, you know, I didn't know at what point does your supply dictate, you know, replenishment levels, you know.
Right. Yeah, well, fair enough.
Like me, it's going to last forever because I don't earl my beard responsibly. So
how dare you.
I take days off and forget. And
but I was looking for something that I saw there, and I'm like, God damn, that would be so easy to put together.
Right.
So I just Googled it, and it was
Turkish man oil, wasn't it? Something you rub all over your chest.
But it was like, there was like 60-some hits for this very thing I was looking to build on Pinterest.
Yeah.
And the only way you can look at them is by joining.
Really? I've looked at stuff on Pinterest before. And
maybe because it was on my phone.
Oh, okay. Because I was going to say, because was it Renee used to post various links to things that were on Pinterest?
Right.
So I would click on that and I could look at it. But I, you know, after that, I always just, you know, burned my eyes for a few minutes.
Well, so I was just like, fuck it. Let me just.
So what you're saying is there's going to be a Salty Language Pinterest page soon.
Maybe. I guess it could.
Please, you need to put stars and rainbows and shit on it. Just be like, our part of the universe.
It has to be like negative rainbows, though, and like narwhals instead of unicorns.
So I should do it, is what you're saying?
Narwhals of bacon capes.
Ooh, bacon capes. That's a good name for a show, but I don't know if it...
The more I peruse, because, you know, fuck, I like cooking, I like building shit, I like beer. They have all these things on there. I'm like, God damn it, I kind of like this.
You do know the internet has all those things as well, right?
Yeah, I know,
just saying.
But, you know.
Just saying.
But I can pin them on boards.
That's true. You do like to pin things on things.
And when I do it,
like
I go,
women
put a
and
pin
walls.
In it.
Right. What?
Put a pin in it.
Nice.
So, yeah.
That's not as good as putting
a burn
on.
I clean, and I fully expect to take shit from people.
I'm surprised you didn't start out with, like, you know, I'm Tony, and I'm a Pinterest-holic or whatever.
That would have been hilarious. That would involve comedic timing, which I lack tonight.
Tonight. Right. I understand. All right. So, we two potential titles for the show name at this point. I'm liking this.
Oh, excellent.
We're not very far in either. That's the beauty of it.
It's true.
Also, I'm paying a little more attention than normal.
Right.
Normally, I don't pay attention until it's my turn to talk. So,
That's hilarious.
That would have been great. Great time for us.
Want my turn.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, there's a break. All right, so you got anything else for the week?
Just kind of, I don't know, this is just something that I just discussed with my wife, which is awesome, but I think it's a new Salty Language product, a new Tonico product.
I like this.
Because we have glasses that I can't wash, these right here, because my hands are too big.
Oh, I understand.
I can't get them in there.
That's why they have those wand things, yeah.
Yeah, so I'm like...
Or children.
But we don't have one of those, so my wife washes the glasses because she's got dinky hands.
I was going to say, you do have children, they have small hands, and sticking them in glass products... Highly recommended.
Perfect.
And that's going on the double stamp part of our website. Children and glass objects.
Well, I told her, though, because she's like, you need to stop using these tall glasses. If you can't wash it, don't drink out of it. And I'm like, no, I drink too much water to use a short glass.
True enough. You know? You'll be walking all day.
And I'm like, why don't we just get a sponge, and I'll put like some sort of like weird dick afro, and I'll just fuck the glass clean. Which she was promptly disgusted by.
And then you admitted to her you've already been doing this. Like, surprise, I've been doing this for 3 months. Especially to your favorite glasses.
That poison ivy one you love.
And the ones you wear in your face. There's another micro about this towel.
Oh yeah.
All right then. That's a phenomenal product, and that will gladly and easily fit in the As Seen on TV section of the Tonico products.
Oh, wait.
Shut up and take my money.
I like it. you know what? Damn it. I had something that was actually an actual shut up and take my money, and I forgot to. Oh, actually, I think I can.
I have one.
I think I can pull it up without.
Actually.
Well, we can get to it. We do those later, though, right?
Okay, all right. Yeah. That's true. But yeah, that's pretty much all I got for my week.
Ooh.
Ooh. Unless you got more stuff.
No, not really.
Actually, I think we should take a brief break so I can fill up my glass and we have to fuck clean later.
Remember, no spots.
Oh, pull out, right?
Right. Yeah, well, you fill up the dish soap container with that, you know, it'll circle of life right there. Then you use that on the thing to clean the glass, right?
Of course.
Because everyone knows, you know, the best cleaner is semen. Acid-free. Or venom-free, sorry. All right, well, let's do that then. We're at 40 minutes, so it's an early break, but we'll take a break here and... We'll come back.
Yeah, definitely need more water. I'm all dry throated over here.
Yeah, that's rare. Yeah. So we will be right back.
Hey, it's your old buddy M2J here. Where could you go to find the greatest podcast about pro wrestling? Why, well, doing the job. Tell us more about it, Denny.
Well, that's right, M2J. You can find the best wrestling podcast in the f-ing world at DTJWrestling.com. And we don't even talk like this, man.
Yeah, man. Like we don't curse either. So probably.
Oh yeah. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, we don't curse on our show.
Well, anyway, as Denny was saying, yeah, DTJWrestling.com. You can find all about our podcast information there, such as on Facebook, on Twitter, and all that other stuff. And we're on the PodGods Network, PodGodsNetwork.com. So come check us out if you like pro wrestling. We usually stream every Tuesday night. What do we like to say, Denny?
See you next Tuesday, where we put wrestling over.
Welcome back to the sexiest podcast on the network.
Oh, they know it now because their loins are tingling.
Oh, boy, mine are.
Yeah. Well, mine always are, but I think it's like a Parkinson's thing. I have groin Parkinson's. It's terrible. I'm going to do a fundraiser for it soon.
Oh, Michael J. Fox dick. Oh, wow.
I was trying to come up with a really good, like, turn of words on Alex P. Keaton, but I couldn't come up with one. So,
Marty! Yeah.
Marty, it's about your dick! What about it, Doc? Your loins are a-quivering! Alright, enough of that. So, I hope you enjoyed hearing about, you know, the Doing the Job podcast and how they, you know, talk about the wrestlings.
Wrestling.
Yeah. If you're a fan of wrestling, seriously, it's not just because they're part of the network, but, you know, go check them out. They put on a really good podcast.
I'm sorry. When you said wrestling, did you mean wrestling?
Oh, of course I meant wrestling.
Okay.
You know,
big, I didn't know what you're talking about for a second.
Big time wrestling, you know.
Right.
Yeah. They do some good bits on there. Like their buy or sell bit is really good. Like where one of them just is like, hey, buy or sell, this is going to happen at the next pay-per-view or whatever. And, you know. And they give each other shit for being wrong about stuff. And they do give each other kudos when they're right.
Well, that's not even cool. We're supposed to just give each other shit no matter what.
True enough. Well, they do. They do.
Oh, okay.
That's part of why I like their show, because they do give each other a lot of shit.
Perfect.
So since we're talking about wrestling, and since the, you know, the millions and millions of our fans demanded it.
It's true.
Or one.
I know.
He wanted me to talk about the Survivor Series that was just this past weekend by the WWE. If you're not a wrestling fan, you probably are going to want to fast forward it for about, I don't know, a minute or two. I'm going to keep talking past that. I'm just, you know, taking
well,
with
it's fair.
Yeah. Anywho, and here's how I'm going to sum up the pay-per-view. It absolutely stunk until the last, like, 5 minutes. It was just not that entertaining. And...
Now, do they still do the classic Survivor Series tournament?
They did two Survivor Series matches in this pay-per-view. One was all Divas, which is just a way for them to get the women on TV once.
Yeah, and I'm jubblies.
I'm not trying to undersell that. That really is all it is. They generally will have, like, and they did. They had the Women's Championship match, and then they just have a match where it's just a bunch of the Divas in the match, whether it's
Here's
a tag team or a battle royal. Or
I want to see all the Divas against Ronda Rousey.
Yeah, Ronda Rousey's probably cleaning
house. In a legitimate fight.
Well, in a legitimate fight, she's probably going to lose because numbers, you know. But if
well,
it's...
I guess that's true.
Yeah.
I don't know. She busts that first arm, they might back off a little.
Yeah, probably. Depends on what you put up, I guess, for the prize, maybe. You know?
Yeah.
like, listen, we know what you guys make, so we're going to vote up $20 million to the winner. Because
right.
you're not going to see this probably in your whole career, which is, you know, whatever. And that's, you know, whatever it is, you know, because they're underutilized, underappreciated by WWE, whatever. Although I will say, WWE puts on a show every Thursday called NXT, to where it's basically like their minor league version of it.
Right.
That's the best show they put on every week. It's an hour-long show, and from open to close, it's pretty much straight wrestling. It's action. It's not like on Raw or something.
It's like up-and-coming dudes.
It is. And it's not like on Raw to where it's like 3 hours, and of that, like 15 minutes is wrestling. The rest of it's just a lot of times. Yeah. So, yeah. So, anywho, at this pay-per-view, you know, the reason me and like Sho enjoy watching wrestling a lot of times is because we try to call stuff before it happens. Like we try, like we're doing like the story angles and stuff, and that comes from watching wrestling since we were, you know, wee lads back in the old country.
Right.
By old country, I mean U.S. We were born here. So that night we were like straight killing it. Like everything we said seemed to be right, and those are nights where it's kind of frustrating because if you see, you can see everything coming. Yeah, you know, there's not
real fun, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, at one point during this, like, the main event was the Team Cena team of, and they were going against Team Authority, okay? And Team Authority is, for those who haven't watched wrestling in, let's say, a few years, if you remember what the corporation was, same thing, essentially. So, and if the Authority lost, they were no longer in control of Raw and SmackDown. So, okay. You know, so obviously big stakes and what have you. Well, at one point, something happened. I forgot what it was. Like, I turned to Sho and I was like, okay, I'm like, who are the final guys in this match? Like, who are the last two wrestlers? And he goes, Dolph Ziggler and Seth Rollins. 100% correct. And I asked him, like, as the match started, basically.
Right.
So I was like, good call. Makes the most sense. Whatever. A little bit later in the match, like, at one point, there's some shenanigans in the ring, whatever. John Cena is getting to his feet, and Big Show standing next to him. And I see Big Show's shoulder turn just a little bit to the left, and I'm like, he's going to fucking punch him. Sure enough, right after that, boom, Big Show hits him, and he falls to the mat and then gets eliminated. And I'm like, well, it had to happen. That's the big one of the big surprises is that Team Cena loses the can't-lose, you know, champion on the team. And right. Someone turned coat. So now they're down two guys. And I'm looking at this, and I'm like, and I looked at Sho. I was like, you know, I was like, I really think Seth Rollins and Dolph Ziggler could put together a really good program and run it for a few months, and it would be good wrestling and the back and forth. I think it'd be entertaining, right? You know, and of course, Sho had already called them, and then, like I said, he was right. It came down to those two. It was just back and forth as far as whatever was going on. You know, there was no pinfall and all this. And I'm looking, and I'm like, okay, I'm like, I've had about enough of this. At some point, this has got to end. And I'm like, there's got to be some shenanigans from, like, Triple H and that because they're the heels. They always have to cheat, essentially.
Do something nefarious.
Sure enough, you know, right as Dolph Ziggler looks like he's about to get the 1-2-3, Triple H pulls the leg of the official so he can't get the 3 count, and then he hits the official, and another official comes out. Basically the same thing. Triple H just interferes and doesn't let that happen, you know.
Oh, like, Hunter Hearst Helmsley.
Well, then he goes over and he drags Seth Rollins. I think he, like, pedigrees Dolph Ziggler after beating the shit out of him. They pull Seth Rollins over on top of him, and I look at Sho and I'm like, it can't end like this, or this is one of the worst pay-per-views I've ever seen. Because this is totally what you see coming.
Right.
You know? And I'm like, they really need a big surprise, and I'm like, I can't think of anything that they could do that's really going to shock me at this point.
I got something.
Okay.
Owen Hart.
Okay, that would shock me. I'll give you that. That would. Now, are we talking zombie Owen Hart, hologram Owen Hart, or just his corpse just drops?
Wait, both. Because it's
I gave zombie. You three options.
Okay, you're right. It's zombie Owen Hart.
Okay.
Because Papa Sean goes there.
He raised him from the dead. Was he Dr. Midnight?
Yes.
I like
now
it.
Now we're talking.
Nice. That's a good call.
Yeah.
So I'm like, you know, Triple H is standing there, and he, like, waves out an official, and I'm like, man, this is how this is going to fucking end. Well, then you hear, like, this random music, and I'm like, who the fuck is that? And then I hear, like, caw, caw, and I'm just like, oh, shit, and the show's like, huh? And I'm like, dude, it's Sting. Sure enough, out walks Sting with the fucking crow makeup on and everything.
Wait, he walked out?
Yeah, well, no, okay, I thought you were going to talk.
Sting.
I thought you were going to talk about like dropping from the ceiling.
No, I'm talking old man. How long? I mean, Jesus, yeah, Sting?
Yeah, he's been around like 1,000 years. I mean, when we were little children, we were, you know, like cheering him on in WCW. So I don't. He's been
Is
around
this before
forever.
Or after he started playing the lute?
Can he do both? Walk out
oh,
and
Ron
play the
Sting. Lute? I'm yeah. sorry.
He came out, had tangerine sex with Triple H. Yeah. And then he was gone.
Triple H just drops loads in his drawers, all confused. Yeah.
Sting plays a little, you know, a couple of police hits, and then he's out, you know. That's the big surprise of the night. No one saw that coming, you know.
Yeah, no, I wouldn't.
So anyway, Sting comes out, and I'm like, holy shit, Sting. Because, again, I didn't see that coming, you know. The right. whole time I'm like, God, I wish that like there was a chance CM Punk could come back, or Daniel Bryan, or Roman Reigns, that are two guys that are injured, and CM Punk is, you know, well, we'll get to that.
On hiatus.
Yeah, we'll get to that. So, you know, but anyway, the Sting thing, I'm, you know, Sting comes in, him and Triple H kind of circle the ring, staring at each other. Triple H has already soaked his shirt, you know, and and then
Sting soaked his defense.
Well, no, no. I got to pull a Married with Children reference here, and we'll call them Sokos.
Nice.
So, anyway, that happens, and then Triple H, like, throws a punch at Sting. He blocks him and then hits him with the Stinger Death Drop.
Right.
And I'm like, all right, I'm waiting for him to, you know, put his hands to his mouth and do the you know, woo that he does. So, no Black Bat. That was a little disappointing, you know, because that would have been great. Have him come out with the bat and basically be like, me and my friend here are going to make sure things go the way they're supposed to go here, you know.
Right.
But whatever. So, anyway, he goes over and he slides. He basically flips the guys so that Seth Rollins is now on the bottom and Dolph Ziggler's on top. And the original official, like, staggers into the ring, you know.
We just came to.
Right. Right. Yeah, exactly. It was, too. He staggers in, 1, 2, 3, Team Authority's out, you know, and the crowd goes crazy because Sting. Sting's right. never been with WWE.
You so, just call him Stink?
Not yet. No.
Okay.
Wait till he wrestles, then maybe. But this is the first time Sting has ever stepped foot
That's
in WWE.
Colossomy bag
That's what the Stinger Death Drop is. Or the Stinger Splash. Oh, God. I was kind of disappointed. I was hoping for a Scorpion Deathlock. I'm not going to lie. But
yeah, it's fair.
But that means he's got to, like, bend down and, you know, his knees
yeah,
probably.
Just sort of weird squatting thing.
And then there could be a real mess.
Yeah, exactly.
You can't clinch when you're squatting, you know.
No.
It's tough. So, anyway, so, you know, so I was like, okay. I looked at show at that point, and I'm like, I was like, that 5 minutes saved this pay-per-view from being a giant stinker. I was like, I'm really glad that, like, because the show has the WWE Network, you know, to where it's like $10 a month, and you get, like, all the pay-per-views.
Right.
Which is, you know, pay-per-views are like $50, $55 for that. So, yeah, I was like, I'm really glad we're not paying for this. Because November was free. So, yeah.
Mm.
But on a side note, I'm looking at him and I'm going, you know, this really sets up Raw to be interesting because Sting can come out and energize the crowd, really kick it off, you know. Yeah, not so much. Sting wasn't on Raw. They didn't even mention him, really. Like, the Authority, when Triple H and Stephanie were out there, they were kind of like, Sting came out and the first time he's ever in a WWE ring and then he does this. And that's pretty much it. That was all that was mentioned of him.
Mm.
I was like, why would you just bring him out for... And I was like, unless maybe it was like an absolute last-minute thing. Maybe they were going to have somebody else run out instead, like Daniel Bryan or somebody run out, and maybe they worked out a deal with Sting to get him to run
like
out or something.
Pop,
yeah,
crowd pop
yeah.
they want.
So I don't know. I mean, it was cool to see the whole idea of Sting, but at the same time, again, he is 90, you know?
Yeah, yeah. That's what I was just thinking. It's like, I mean, I haven't watched wrestling in a while, but they just keep bringing back, from what I understand, older guys, because I mean, the newer guys just not have that like aura of, you know, wrestling around.
Yes, yes, and no. A lot of these new guys don't. I mean, John Cena is the absolute biggest draw for WWE, hands down, no question. Right.
Right.
He gets booed as much as he gets cheered at stadiums.
Right.
It is mind blowing to see how over he used to be, and he was like the shit, and now he's booed completely. in the same place. Like, you know, it used to be like you'd, The Rock would come out and either the crowd would boo him or they would cheer him generally. You wouldn't generally hear a whole lot of both. Same with Stone Cold and guys like that. But Cena comes out, and I mean, you hear, like, if you really are listening, you can, it's almost like, you know, one speaker's putting the ah and the other's ooh out. But the other side of it is, you know, like you were saying, when they bring back some of these older guys, they haven't been on TV in a while or whatever, you know, it's a cheap pop, you know.
Yeah.
Which, I'm really
Sting. I mean, where's Ricky the Dragon Steamboat?
Oh, he's well retired.
Or is he in the ground?
Okay, so Sting was born March 20th, 1959, so he's 55 years old. So he's not as old as I thought he was, but he's still pretty old, especially for a pro wrestler.
Yeah, to be thrown around and doing physical shit.
In fairness, if he does any sort of a wrestling program, it's probably not going to be until closer to WrestleMania. They're going to probably do something similar with him that they've done with, like, Undertaker, where they pretty much keep him off TV or he does a real, real occasional thing, and then you bring him back a few months before WrestleMania so he can get his timing and everything back, and then he makes his run and then disappears for another year. And that seems to be what everyone seems to think it is with Sting, too, is that he'll come back.
Because about 2 pints of cortisone going through all their joints.
Probably. Well, Jesus. You know, because Sting's never been in a WrestleMania. So the thought is they bring him back, give him a WrestleMania moment, and then, you know, whatever. So, yeah, I don't know. So there, I hope that satisfied Henno. Even though we do have more wrestling news.
Oh, shit.
And this is pretty new wrestling news, actually. This is one I hadn't even seen, which was that CM Punk opens up on his WWE exit, which this is from IGN.com. But it's also, they got this from the Colt Cabana Art of Wrestling podcast. And basically CM Punk has been real quiet about his leaving WWE. He just kind of left. And there's been all sorts of speculation that it was him and Triple H didn't get along. That basically he was just like, fuck it. He didn't like the creative direction. He, you know, all that kind of stuff. And apparently from his own admission that it's about his mental health, that he was miserable and he has enough of a bank balance to no longer need to wrestle.
The old fuck you money.
Yep. So he said, money's not everything, ladies and gentlemen. That will be a big theme in my story. And it makes sense because he's still got time on his contract. And during that time, first of all, WWE will go after him for breach.
Right.
Because that's just business. That, you know, no matter what, they would do that. Second of all, any T-shirts that are sold during this time, he absolutely is going to make zip on. Whereas if he was actively wrestling, he would get whatever the negotiated cut is.
You know? Now, do you think that he's enough of a name that once the WWE's behind him and he can go, I don't know, I don't even know his name.
Like his real name?
Yeah.
It's Phil something. I forgot his last name.
Wow, I was just going to say Phil just because it's a funny name.
It's Phil something, yeah. I can't remember. Right, so, I used to know and I can't remember now.
So let's say once all this is behind him, because he obviously can't be CM Punk.
Well, no, he owns that name.
Does he?
He does.
Because, holy shit, how'd he pull that off?
Because he's had that name since, like, back in the day. Like, he had that name with ECW.
Oh, no shit.
Yep.
Okay, well then he'll be fine.
Right.
With the name, he can draw, you know.
Right, like if you come up through WWE, a lot of times they own at least a portion of this or that. A lot of times they own it because, you know, for the longest time, Vince used to come up with the gimmick. They'd come up with a bunch of gimmicks, and then when a guy would come up, they would just go, this one.
Yeah.
So they already owned whatever. Now a lot of these guys are coming from other places.
Okay, that's good to know because it's like, you know, I remember like
his
like
name
China.
Is actually legally CM Punk also.
Oh, well, there you go.
Yeah.
But, yeah, like, I remember China when she got booted. Couldn't be China anymore. She was, like, I don't know, Asia Minor.
No, she went by China, but she had to add.
Oh, it's China Doll.
Yeah, China Doll. I was going to say, I think she added, like, an N in there and then the word doll, yeah. And you used to see that all the time. You'd see, like, you know, someone bounce from WWE, they'd go to WCW, and they'd have to change their name just slightly or whatever, or vice versa, you know.
Right.
But since probably the 90s, you don't see that as much because a lot of the guys – well, some of the guys go by their real names too, you know.
Right. Which Vince owns.
Otherwise, you're fine. Anyway,
you're hard. So
the best part
there
of what
I – going to be John Doe from now on.
John Doe, yeah. Oh, and he'd probably make him a baker too. You go with Vince's like 80s gimmicks.
Yes.
Ugh. So it says that, you know, apparently in this interview, which Colt Cabana and CM Punk are like super besties. So I'm not surprised that, you know, if he's going to tell a story, he went to his pals podcast.
First of all,
you help him out, give him all the listeners.
Just to be fair, he could have come to the sexiest podcast.
We offered him a mic spot on our show. Like, he'd come here and it would be the CM Punk podcast with Salty Language.
Yeah.
Or with the Enthusiast.
Yes.
As of right now, our attorneys have not heard anything back from his camp.
That's true.
And I'm sure that if we do, it'll probably be, fuck you.
Of course, it doesn't help. Our attorney picture was just, you know, my pets of a briefcase next
to him. Oh, my God. You need to write that down, and that needs to happen somehow. Whether it's your pets or, you know, random internet picture, that needs to happen. Yeah, so Punk talks about a couple things. We'll have the link to the article on there, which I would suggest, rather than reading the article, you just go download the Art of Wrestling podcast, because it's a pretty good podcast anyway.
Well, I've heard CM Punk on all our podcasts. He's pretty good.
He's fantastic. And that's the funny
thing. He's a good talker. So.
Is that a lot of, you know, like when people talk about the money he's leaving and stuff, it's like, okay, if CM Punk announces tomorrow that the CM Punk podcast is coming out, it's going to get a shit ton of downloads. I mean, including me, I'll be one of the first ones, you know, I'll be right in there downloading it, because he's an interesting guy who loves comics and, you know, all sorts of, like, like, he's a huge Walking Dead fan, you know, he loves Kirkman and Brubaker, and, you know, so I would definitely listen to, and if he's talking about wrestling and this other stuff, especially if he's dropping pipe bombs on there, I'm all for it.
Right.
Or, I can't imagine he couldn't get himself a job somewhere as... He's just such a good personality. I could see a lot of places being interested in his services. You know, because
plus to draw the name alone.
That's what I mean, on top of it, too. Yeah, and you're not getting just some lug on there. You're getting a guy who's actually good on the microphone. You know, if it's another wrestling promotion at some point, he's fantastic calling the matches as well.
Right.
Because he's done that a couple of times on Raw, and it's fantastic because he always wears, like, a suit jacket when he does. But most of the time, he's still wearing his wrestling, like his underwear, wrestling trunks, and then wearing like a suit jacket. And he comes out and, you know.
Well, because official.
Right. And he's great. So, you know. But anyway, one of the things that was interesting about this was. Where was that? I'm trying to find the thing about the Triple H thing. I can't find it. Shit. He basically talks about how Triple H, he's never felt that Triple H really liked him. Like, or respected him. And that's probably true. He doesn't fit. Triple H is of the mentality of kind of like, you have to have a certain look to be a pro wrestler kind of a thing. And then he doesn't, you know, CM Punk doesn't fit that. He's not real ripped. He's not a big guy, you know, that basically he would fit the old school, like, cruiserweight look, like Jericho and those guys, you know,
the high flying.
Yeah. Even though Punk doesn't do a ton of high flying, you know. But anyway, one part here, he says, I'm the fucking happiest I've been in I don't know how long, at least 3 years, legitimately. Part of that probably has to do with, I mean, he did just, you know, marry AJ Lee also.
I don't know who that is. She's she's attractive.
WWE diva. She was the champion until this last weekend.
Oh, collusion. It's a conspiracy.
I'm sure that
she's going to lose the belt.
Oh, here we go. Before Punk left WWE, they were looking like they were going to gear up for Triple H and CM Punk at WrestleMania. And Punk says he didn't give Triple H that match because he didn't, quote, he didn't want to give him the fucking privilege, end quote.
Oh, there you go. Well, yeah, I guess the best way would be just check out that podcast.
Yeah.
After you listen to this podcast.
Of course.
Of course. Like, don't bow out of this one.
No,
finish
absolutely
this
not.
Fucking podcast.
Absolutely not. And after you listen to that, send CM Punk things telling him he should come on our podcast.
Also, yes.
I can't remember if he's at CM Punk still. I know his, like, username was The Coach for a while, which I have no idea why he was doing that. But the last time I checked, he hasn't posted anything on Twitter in a long time. And for a while, he was posting pretty regularly. And then once he left WWE, he just kind of cooled it.
Well, I imagine when he left, everyone's like adding him.
Yeah.
No, dude!
Here's something I just saw. This is really interesting. An example Punk offers revolves around a sponsorship deal. He was offered a huge sponsorship deal after the pipe bomb moment, which was when he sat on the ramp, basically, and was just talking about how he just laying down like all these truths about WWE and stuff. And it says he then pitched the idea to Vince McMahon, which would see Punk wearing UFC-style fight shorts. McMahon nixed the idea as it could potentially cause problems. Lower guys on the card couldn't get the same deals, thus leading to jealousy. McMahon told Punk it wasn't Punk's hill to die on, then brought in Brock Lesnar, who wears UFC fight shorts with sponsors on the ass. Another example, Punk cites WWE saying one thing and doing another, is when Punk wanted to walk out alongside his friend and fighter Chael Sonnen in a UFC event.
Right.
When Punk told McMahon, the chairman's response was that UFC was barbaric and that someone might die. Shortly after Punk's request, Triple H walked boxer Floyd Mayweather to the ring. So, yeah, there's, like I said, there's... Wow.
It's people might die in the UFC. Have they seen the past rosters of the WWE?
Yeah, right? That's, yeah.
I'm just saying.
Yeah, there's some really good, just from me skimming, there are some really good, like, sound bites in there, which is not a surprise at all, because it's CM Punk's great at sound bites, and this is probably, he's had all this time to let it kind of stew and fester and everything so that he can, like,
ferment.
Right. So, you know, when he's laying down those words, they can be arrows instead of, you know, just being whatever hits your mind, you know?
Are you saying he's dropping smart truth bombs?
Yes. I certainly am.
Ah, I see.
So anyway, there's that. That's all our wrestling news for the week. Unless Tony has something that would surprise me. Aside from Owen Hart.
I got... nothing.
Exactly.
Just the sound effect.
All right. So what do you want to move into here? TV, comic books, football?
Whatever. And I have a Shut Up and Take My Money.
Oh, I have one, too, because I did find the one. It would be funny as hell if it's the same one. It wouldn't shock me either.
It wouldn't shock me either.
Well, let's do this real quick. Did you see they cast Apocalypse for the new X-Men movie?
Yeah.
Oscar Isaac is his name?
Yeah.
I think it's an interesting pick. He's got a good look to him, I think, for the role. I'm not real familiar with his body of work, but, you know, I don't know. It cracks me up. And again, you know, generally I don't read comments on this shit, but it cracks me up so much when people are like, one of the comments is how he doesn't have the right body for it,
or CGI.
Yeah, I was gonna say Apocalypse is gonna probably be all CGI.
Yeah,
I'd be surprised if he's not, because he's supposed to be a larger character. And again, I'm really more interested in, can the person pull the role off? Can they act? Can they do the role? More than I am about their body being right. Because, again, it's Hollywood. They can fix a lot of shit.
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, don't get me wrong. There's sometimes where, like, Hugh Jackman, like, if you want to talk about body type, Hugh Jackman's way too tall to be Wolverine, especially now as a paperweight.
Right.
But but through the movies, you know, he's, like, 6 foot tall, and Wolverine's supposed to be, like, 5'2 or something, you know? So, and they didn't shoot him like it was The Hobbit to make him look shorter. They just, you know, let him be the height he was. Oscar Isaac is his last name.
Yeah, he was, let's see here, he was in Drive, he was in Sucker Punch, he was in the newest Robin Hood with...
he was in Sucker Punch, wasn't he?
Yeah. Apparently he's in the new Star Wars movie, which we're going to talk a little bit about.
Ooh, foreshadowing. Yeah.
Yeah. It looks like he's having a good year.
Yeah, I think this isn't one of those where, you know, especially
He was in All About the Benjamins.
Oh, nice. For these kind of movies where they're doing, like, the prequels thing, and to me, I'm not looking at, like, there's no previously cast Apocalypse, really, for him to butt heads with. Like, there's no Heath Ledger Joker, you know what I mean? To where it's like, boy, I wouldn't want to be the next guy playing that role, you know?
Right.
Or even Heath Ledger, you know, after Nicholson did what he did, nobody really, you know, like, boy, that's a tough role to go do.
Yeah, I'm sure he'll be fine as Apocalypse.
Yeah. I think it's pretty neat. I don't have a problem with that. And I saw, like, a straight-on shot of his face and stuff, and he looks kind of like, you know, like when you picture, like, the lines of Apocalypse on his face and stuff. I was like, you know what? I think he's going to look pretty good in the role.
Right.
Again, the question will be, can he act in, you know, what do they do with the character? So...
Yeah, exactly.
That's more important, you know. Like, how well is it the movie written?
Thomas.
Oh, damn it!
Damn it!
They say there's one characteristic.
Yeah, there was a pop-up window on this page I had.
Oh,
fucking A! Like, it wasn't there. Like, I checked earlier, it wasn't there. It just came up when I went back to the site.
Well, of course it did, Brian.
Jerks. So another show that we talk about each week, Constantine. Did you see what happened with that this week?
You know, I saw it was canceled, but then other reports saying it's not canceled.
It's not canceled. What is it? NBC said that they're not going to pick, like, you know, a lot of TV shows, they'll do 13 episodes, and then they have to pick up the additional, like Gotham was 13 originally. It was almost immediately picked up for 13 more.
Right.
Which we'll see in, like, 16 months or whatever. Anyway, so Constantine's only getting 13 episodes for the first season.
Right.
Which I saw people freaking out about, and it's like, you do remember Walking Dead only had, like, 8 or 10 episodes in the first season, right? It's not that big a deal. Like, calm your tits. That means the DVD will be cheaper.
I mean, it's, you know, what did you think of the last episode?
I thought the last episode was the best episode.
Yeah, it was pretty good.
I thought it was pretty good. I'm loving the Dr. Midnight character. Like, I really like the guy that they got playing his part. I think he's really good. And I think his cronies are, you're getting a little more taste of what they're going to be to the show. That, I think, has been really important and lacking.
Yeah.
Because remember, I asked a couple weeks ago, I'm like, what's going on with that woman? Is she, you know, like, is she really helping him, or is she, you know, whatever?
It made me realize I haven't read enough Constantine for, like, his like, manservant that can die and then comes back and heals himself up or whatever.
That was pretty cool. Yeah. I kind of figured that when I saw, you know, the woman just, like, going crazy on him with the freaking scissors, you know? Which I thought, that was a pretty cool. I liked the individual, like, stories of the characters I thought were pretty good, too. Her and the hitchhiker guy and the, you know.
Yeah, it was kind of interesting how they did it. It was, a three-part little thing going on.
And Constantine wasn't solving each piece of that. You know, his cronies were doing some work. So, like I said, you know, you get a little taste of what they're going to, how they're going to help, right? So, I don't know. I think the show finally hit a mark where I'm like, okay, you know, like, fine. Yeah. You know, we talked about how there's never been really an episode where I've come out of it with, like, it was all right. I thought this was a pretty good episode. And he was fucking smoking in the episode. Did you see it?
I know. Yeah, I did see that.
Like, finally. Again, I know that really shouldn't be.
To me.
Shouldn't be that big of a deal, but it just makes.
Given the environment we live in now, it is big deal.
And it just, it's who we know as the character. Like, if you have no idea anything about Constantine, you don't give two shits.
Right.
I'll cite Wolverine. It's the same thing. If you've never seen Wolverine smoking a cigar in the books, you don't give a shit. But there's so many times that Wolverine will have just, like, slaughtered, like, 40 ninjas, and then he turns around and you see him lighting his cigar, you know?
Yeah.
He needs that to calm himself down or whatever, you know?
That sweet, delicious Cuban nicotine.
It's probably not Cuban, though.
Nah, he's Wolverine. He's got connections.
Certainly does. Yeah. He's like, hey, Nightcrawler, here's what the inside of that store looks like.
Yeah, bamf.
Bamf, bamf. Here you go. Like, yes. Does that count as importing if Nightcrawler brings it in?
Probably, but it's mutant, so...
Because he's not really crossing a border, per se. He's turning into... Well, I guess he kind of is. I don't know.
It's like splitting dimensions or something.
Yeah. So.
But what did you feel about Gotham with its mostly Bruce Wayne-centric episode?
First of all, this was the fall finale of Gotham, which means it'll be months before we get another episode.
Right. Because
they were like, hey, Walking Dead does this. This is a great idea. I know there's other shows that do it, too, but I absolutely hate the idea of it, but I get it. You know, you put out 13 episodes, you need 13 more, or 8, 10, whatever the hell number we're at, you know. I hate the Selina Kyle story so much.
Yep. Same here.
I love that I got to see Alfred whipping ass with that, like, cane or whatever.
Yeah, and capping dudes.
Yeah. Although I did think it was funny. Dude shot Alfred in the shoulder, and he just turns like, whatever, dude. And then he just, like, pop, pop, shoots the other guy in the shoulder, and the guy goes flying in the air. And I'm like, really, though? It's like, he's not rocking, like, some huge caliber gun that's going to take you off your feet any more than the guy would have done to Alfred, you know?
Looks like he's got the little Bond Walther PPK.
Yeah, so it's like, okay, so what we learned there is that Alfred knows how to take a shot.
Yeah.
He's like, you just turn your shoulder into it, and then no big deal.
He's no bitch.
Right. So I'm guessing we're supposed to assume that Alfred just got winged, and the other guy was, like, full-on shot in the shoulder.
I guess.
Which clearly knocks you down.
Clearly.
That kind of made me laugh a little bit, but, yeah, whatever, you know.
Yeah. I know I've said it, like, probably every week. They could just cut Bruce Wayne out of the show, and I'd be much happier.
I know. I kind of liked the, you know, they're setting up all the shenanigans and whatnot. Like, if they removed the Selina Kyle story from Wayne Manor and just moved it anywhere else in Gotham, I wouldn't have a problem with it.
Right. Because, you know, it's all happening Wayne Manor, though, right?
Yeah. Because it's like, okay, now you just showed me that, first of all, Alfred will answer and or let anybody into Wayne Manor, which I don't buy for a second.
Right.
Now, I understand he doesn't have a bat cave to protect at this point, but he does have like a 12-year-old boy to protect. You'd think that aside from his, you know, the rentals he gets from me from Hobo Canyon, he wouldn't just let anybody in.
True.
I mean, you know, everyone's got to have some playtime, but this is a little ridiculous.
Well, that's why Alfred's also got to protect his vintage pornography collection.
Right. You said phonography collection, correct? Yeah,
yes. He's got a big steamer trunk at the end of his bed full of them.
Yeah, he does. Wait. Yeah, I was kind of like, I know the woman had like the bloody forehead and stuff, but I'm kind of like, still don't know that he's, you know, I don't know that he's letting her in that easily, because he like immediately was like, oh, you poor dear, come, you know, it's like,
oh dear, come in here.
Like, the way he's acted with Bruce and stuff at times, it's like he's so hard edged all the time, but then he sees, you know, some dame with like a little blood on her forehead, and he's like, oh my god.
Well, it's been a while. He was hoping to, you know.
I stitch you up. Yeah, I get you. Exactly. Yeah, I get you. All right.
Yep.
Maybe she gives him a, you know, a rough handy, and then.
Yeah.
I get you.
A thank you for the Band-Aid handy.
Bandy.
Oh, Bandy. Yes, exactly.
Yeah. You know, once I got past that, I was just kind of like, you know, I really did enjoy watching him in the fight scenes. That was pretty cool, you know, because I like the badass Alfred. We've said that.
Now, how do you feel about them in, you know, at the fall finale with Gordon being reassigned to Arkham Asylum as a security guard?
I'm going to let you go first on that one.
I think it's interesting because I kind of want to see what they do with Arkham. But at the same time, like Arkham was always cool because it was full of Batman's rogues, which don't really
wouldn't exist. Exactly. Yeah, right now it's just crazy people.
Yeah.
You know. Yeah, I kind of thought that, too, because as soon as they were, you know, they were like, blah, blah, you know, when Bullock's like, oh, man, you know, guard it, Arkham, you know, and I was kind of like, okay, it makes sense, because this is how we're going to finally get to see the interior of Arkham, basically, for a little bit, you know, because obviously he's not going to stay a guard there for very long.
No, I wouldn't think so.
Yeah, I wouldn't think so either. I did appreciate the line when Edward Nygma came up and Bullock was like, you should take him with you, you know, and I was kind of laughing. It's like, he'll be there soon enough, you know.
Right, yeah, for sure.
But yeah, I don't know. I'm not, I almost feel like this was in my head, that this was one of the worst episodes.
Yeah, well, I didn't really care for it myself.
I don't know if that's entirely, like, because again, I've been liking it more and more, but I just, I like the whodunit aspect and the cop aspect of the show that it's been doing, and there's a little of that in this one. Yeah. And obviously, you know, the mayor is, you know.
Well, I didn't even like that, you know, when Selina and Bruce are on the run.
Yeah.
And they're in that, you know, basically in, like, the Foot Clan layer from Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles the movie.
Right.
You know?
It probably
all the kids
was
running around.
Yeah, yeah.
And they run into Poison Ivy.
Oh, that I forgot about that. Oh.
And they're really like turning in or some turned in some sort of like weird little sociopath kid.
Right. You know, I was thinking this the other day about this show, and that I think they're forcing their villain personas on them too much when they're little kids.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, I can understand she's mad at Gordon and Bullock or whatever for what happened with her dad or whatever, or she's, you know. But it's like, why would she be pissed at Bruce over that? That doesn't make any sense. And the way she's acting, it's like, first of all, can you please? And like, I'm watching this yesterday, and I'm like, oh, I'm all out of ham. Thank God she's bringing plenty of it to the table. Because overact, oh my God.
With her being pissed is when they were, you know, whatever episode it was that you met her family, she's clearly dirt-ass poor.
Right.
And to have some billionaire kid running around.
Right. I guess there's that. Yeah.
Like in her territory or whatever, her turf.
Well, and she was, like, you could tell they were showing us essentially that his family, I can't think of the guy's name now, her dad, Pepper, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that he abused her mom and her, or whatever. You could kind of get that vibe from that episode, and then I was just like, I don't know. I just, it's another one of those characters I don't like at this point. And I think it's because I feel like they're trying to put adult Poison Ivy into child Poison Ivy's body and brain.
Yeah, I hear you.
I don't necessarily, and I may be wrong because I'm not a big time science, you know, like knowing person, but I was waiting for. I thought you were going to drop a yeah, science there.
I thought about it, right. But I was like, I don't want to cut him off.
Shit, now we don't ruin the...
yes, science!
There.
So, I don't know how early in your life being a psychopath kind of a thing or a sociopath, how early that truly develops. But it feels like they've got her, like, on the brink of it.
Right.
Like, to where the next step is that she's going to be doing, like, Dexter shit, you know?
Yeah. Oh, it's planned.
Yeah. And it's like, yeah, I don't know.
Which, that's another thing. Well, you know, I hate to get stuck on that stupid ginger character, but...
come on now, he puts out a decent podcast.
Not that
ginger. Just kidding, we love you, Jason, mostly.
Has there been any, like, with her, any, like, love of plants? Like, when they're in her apartment, did she have plants in her windowsill or something?
I thought she was messing with plants when the police were there, when they went back. I thought they were messing with plants. Or maybe it was originally... I thought she was, like, kind of doing something with... I don't know. They're probably going to change it anyway. I guess I'm just about... She's another one of those characters that I'm just meh about, you know?
Yeah.
I was a little disappointed that in the fall finale, like, Penguin, who has been, like, the whole show, was in for, like, felt like 2 minutes.
Right.
It felt like this was, like you said before, it was almost like they were, like... And was this a longer episode? I didn't pay attention.
No, it just felt like it.
Okay.
Yeah.
I didn't know if, you know, with it being the fall finale, if maybe it'd be an hour and a half or something, you know. But it felt like it was, like, you know, 50, 60% Bruce, and then the rest of it, you know, like, a little bit of it was the Gordon part, and I don't know.
It was mostly, you know, Bruce and Selina, it felt like.
Right. Now, I am curious to see... That for the fall finale, they didn't really do any more with the whole Mendoza and Barbara, whatever her name is.
Well, because they're too busy scissoring.
Good call. Bumping triangles. They're too raw to walk. Gotcha.
Yep, exactly.
Because I kind of figured that they would touch on a little bit on every little piece that they could, kind of like Game of Thrones did. You know, they give you a little taste of like everything in the finale, even if they don't fully... wrap it up.
When you're in a restaurant, they bring the dessert cart by.
right. It's like you're in Olive Garden getting the taste of Italy.
Oh, God, not me.
Well, no, I actually think I'm pretty right on here because I didn't like most of it.
Oh, okay. Well, all right.
Yeah, so.
You gave me to run, so we're right.
Wow, watching TV did that? That's pretty harsh, man. You should write the show about that if that's the case. Speaking of the runs, let's talk about The Flash.
Nice segue.
Yeah. That's how we do it up here in the pros. So in this episode, the synopsis quickly is that there's another superpowered being with he's Electro.
Basically.
And he's pretty much Electro. Boogie woogie. So, you know, he shoots the Flash at one point, and then the Flash is like, oh, my powers are gone.
Yeah, oh, geez, you sucked out my lightning or something.
Whoops-a-daisy.
It seems like he could, like, absorb electricity from shit around him, right?
Yeah, and he can feel the electricity. So that's why I said he's pretty similar to Electro. I think they have really similar powers. I didn't catch his name. Like, did they give him a villain name? Like, did the long-haired goof give him a name?
Yeah, he did, and I don't remember what it was
now. You talk about the episode a little bit. I'll pull it up.
All right. I don't know. The whole Flash losing his powers thing was, you know.
You knew that had to happen at some point because every good show like that, you know, Batman loses his utility belt and has to get out of something or isn't himself mentally or, you know, there's always that bullshit. Superman gets kryptonite around him. There's always, you know.
Yeah, right, exactly. But, yeah, it was the whole, oh, I can't run all so, you know, I don't know. I didn't really care for that.
Right.
You know.
I was waiting for him to get jump-started by, like, Iris, like, kissing him or something. I was waiting for, and I'm like, God, I hope they don't, because I felt like a CW kind of thing, you know?
That would be, the music plays.
Yeah, and I'm sitting there going, oh, please, please be wrong about this. Because, you know, again, I do the same thing watching pretty much any TV show that I do watching wrestling. I try to figure out what's going to happen the whole time.
Right.
Which ruins a lot of TV for me. I will not lie about that.
I do like how Wheels threw the...
For the record, his name is Dr. Wells, but anyways...
Yeah, like...
Oh, no. I'm saying Wells, Wheels. It's so...
Oh, Dr. Wheels.
I think that somebody was having a joke there.
I like how he threw Colossus under the bus.
Yeah. Yeah.
Completely.
Yeah, he did. That was pretty strong. Yeah, because it was interesting because when he went to his little future whatnot and was like, you know, show me instances of the Flash, and it's like none found, and he immediately started panicking because he's like, he knows from what we've seen before how important the Flash is to the future.
for some reason.
Which, spoilers, if you haven't figured out that the treadmill and the Flash and the future are important, you need to go read Crisis.
Yeah, exactly.
Anywho, which, again, I guess I just kind of jumped to the end of the show because that was a little bit at the end of the show this week.
Right.
Was basically Barry going, you know, I want to push myself. And I'm like, oh, it's coming.
Yeah.
At some point, you know, he's going to kill himself.
What, he went even faster in that episode when...
Well, look at the last episode. He went stupid fast so he could do the Sonic Punch or whatever.
Yeah, and this time he was, like, going almost as fast as light, basically.
Right.
Yeah. I don't know.
Oh, my God, that guy's name was Farouk?
Farouk.
Blackout's his name.
Blackout. I was like, I knew it was something goofy.
The guy's real name, well, not real name, but character name is Farouk. Man, he should have been hitting guys with spine busters and shit.
I know. The Nation?
Right. Because there's nothing like a Farouk spine buster.
Farouk spine buster.
Yeah, a little more wrestling back there for you. Back when he was in the APA and stuff.
But yeah, still enjoying the Flash.
Or the Dominator, which was his finisher. Anyway.
Nice.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think there was nothing real stand out about the episode.
No, decent episode, though, besides, but not
like,
great.
Like you said, the Easter eggs of the treadmill and stuff like that. But
also, I think with what we saw from Dr. Wheels, whatever. Yeah. I remember last week, I was like, yeah, we haven't quite seen anything where he's completely tipped the scale that he's not a good guy. I think this week he pushed it pretty far.
Yeah.
With throwing that dude under the...
willing to just throw lives away to make sure the future is what he wants the future
also,
to be.
Also, when he gets the when he takes the sample off of Blackout at the end, when he was basically alluding like he can stop the Flash with this.
Like, oh, you can steal the Flash's power.
Right. So as he twists,
yeah, so I have to grease up my ball bearings in my wheelchair.
So yeah, you know. So I think I'm glad that it's not. You know, we're far enough into the season that I'm glad that it was. That they're kind of like tipping the scale a little bit on this, like one way or the other, you know?
Yeah.
Because I wanted him to basically either kind of dictate that he is mostly a good guy or that, and now it's like he's got some real shadiness around him.
Oh, yeah.
Because the end is real shady, and then the whole throwing, what's his name, under the bus? It's like, well, he's not.
He's just calling Colossus.
Yes. It's like he's not a problem going into the future, I guess, because.
Which kind of leads me one question.
How do they kill everybody on that show?
Well, yeah. Anyway. But no, they're locking all these jerk-offs into the Star Labs,
right.
You know, like
right.
Vault or whatever.
Yep.
How are they keeping these people alive? Are you, like, vacuum tubing food to them? And, I mean, they
don't
just looking too deep into it.
They just don't care. No.
Because, you know, actually... like, in the last episode, you know, Colossus was like, not the last one, the previous one. It's like, what do you do? All like clearly pissed off that he's getting locked in this thing, and then the door closes and he gets put in some little weird compartment.
Yeah.
It's like, well then what?
It's like you feel like you're looking at the the negative zone jail, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, where they have like all these superpowered villains from like all over the universe and whatever, and it's like, how the hell do they
like who walks around with a tray of glop and slides it under the door?
Oh, I don't slide it under the door. I just walk around with the tray.
Oh.
Just teasing him.
Teasing him.
Oh, I'm sorry. He's a metahuman. I forgot. They are calling them metahumans. They're not calling them superheroes, which is weird because DC is one of the companies that owns the copyright on the term superhero. Why wouldn't you just fucking use superhero?
That's a good question.
You know why? Because it seems less corny. Metahuman does.
Yeah, I mean, probably.
Marvel's going to, you know, I mean, you've seen, like, with Marvel what they're doing, right? How it looks like they're going to use the term inhuman instead of mutant so that they can get around their deal with Fox.
Right.
With some of the characters. Because, there's going to be, Quicksilver's going to be in the new Avengers movie.
Right.
And he was in X-Men, and that, you know, I was like, how can they do that? Because I thought... Generally, if one company, you know, sells their character, the rights to another company, the characters involved are clearly dictated, you know?
Yes.
And, you know, if you have the X-Men universe, you're going to want, Quicksilver and whatnot, because, first of all, he was a badass in that movie.
Right.
His scenes were some of the best in that X-Men movie, but, whatever.
A goddamn cat when I alone.
Yeah.
There's about ready to be a small hole in the plaster lined of fur and blood.
And it's going to be yours. You're going to get over there, go to hit the cat. Cat's just going to fucking arm drag you through the wall.
Every time I see the cat now, I don't hear meowing. I just hear,
dark gravelly voice
right?
from Arrow.
Right.
I can barely understand what he's saying.
No matter what, the Slade voice for me is always going to now be the one from Teen Titans, the cartoon. Because I forgot who did that. That guy was fantastic.
Yeah, that was great.
Not that Manu Bene was bad. He was really good.
He was a great Slade, but
yeah.
That voice though.
Yeah. I'm picturing, you know, your cat wings you through the wall, and then, you know, as you go to turn, there's like a sword at your throat, you know.
Yeah, basically.
I wouldn't advise that.
Who taught you how to fight, kid?
I did. That's actually a line in the damn show. Have you got to that part yet?
Yeah, I told you. I pounded through season two.
Well, no, I couldn't remember if that was season two or season three. I couldn't remember. So, okay. Because I was going to say that's actually a line in there. It was like, you've forgotten, you know, who trained you, kid. Damn it. Hilarious.
Yes.
Yeah, I know. We'll be talking about that show more before too long because Tony's getting close to catching up on it. So, what'd you think of season two of that? We can talk about that real quick.
I liked it.
Better than season one, right?
Yeah.
Like the action and stuff. I think the storyline really picked up, which I think has a lot to do with Brubaker having something to do with the Deathstroke Slade storyline.
Yeah, and that was a strong storyline. I like the fact that they depowered him.
Yeah.
You know, but they didn't kill him.
Exactly.
Which is cool because it's always a chance he can come back then, despite the fact he's locked away in a hidey hole.
Yeah. Which is beautiful because you want him to come back because he's one of those characters that you love it when he comes back because he's such a good villain, you know?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking because
he needs to be away at times. You know, you can't just
every week have him all the time.
It's like Green Goblin and Spider-Man. It's like every time they reboot Spider-Man, they're like Green Goblin. I'm like, yeah, how about no? How about use other characters?
Okay, Hobgoblin.
Yeah.
Damn it.
Mecha Goblin. What?
But yeah,
Hobo Goblin.
I'm like,
did you hear that?
What?
I said Hobo Goblin.
Oh, that would be awesome.
He's got fucking... He throws like Molotov cocktails in paper bags. It's like pumpkin beer. He's just winging.
He doesn't have pumpkin beer. He doesn't have the Goblin Glider. It's just a stolen bike.
Right. He wraps newspaper around himself. Yeah. I forgot what it was that... was it Heno or whatever said to me, or was it Clint? I can't remember. One of the guys, they made a comment about the Hobo Times or something like that. Newspaper. I'm like, yeah. I was like, it covers the finest in hobos. And I was meaning, like, they use it as a blanket. Not that they do news stories on hobos. Or both, if you wish. That's fine. All right, enough hobo talk.
In the end of the episode, that's all I could think. I'm like, they can't kill him.
No.
But but the way it was going, it was almost like forcing his hand to
kill
him.
It really was. But I like that. Well, they had to, and you know that was the point of it, is obviously that was the big test for Arrow because of the whole, like, remember, like, last season, it was like, you know, I'm blah, 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 I'm protecting my city, I am there, or whatever. And now this season it was like, I used to be a killer, but now I'm better than that.
Yeah. I kind of like him. He's just dropping everybody.
Yeah, but now they were like, well, the Flash is killing everyone, so we can't. Yeah. Like, the Flash has a higher body count, you know, of like, the supervillain-type characters, I think, than Arrow does at this point.
I think you're right.
Like, of overall people, no. But of, like, supervillains, I think so. And, you know, part of that skewed for The Flash because, you know, Malcolm, what's-his-face on the Arrow, you know, doesn't ever seem to die.
Right.
So.
But, yeah, I liked it.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Have you gotten to the Ra's al Ghul stuff yet? No?
I mean, okay. Not in season three, just this stuff with...
His daughter.
We're only a few episodes in. I mean, what's her name? You know, came back after the Canary took a plunge off a rooftop.
Yeah.
But yeah, we haven't. I was kind of hoping they're gonna get into him.
By the way, I'll say this. I'll say it directly to your wife because I know she'll listen to this. If you think the girl who plays Lauren was annoying now, wait till you get a few more episodes into this season.
Oh, Christ,
she's fucking annoying. There's one in every one of these TV shows. There's always that one character that you wish they would, like, get Gwen Stacy'd, you know?
Well, we just saw the episode where she was, like, gonna take matters in her own hands because this guy's beating up her chick, and she shows up with a bat and the guy kicks her ass in an alley.
Yeah. That was pretty funny. I like that, actually.
Yeah,
not that she got,
you got your ass beat.
Yeah, it was just, you know, your hubris got your ass beat. Next time, think first.
Yeah, really. So, I don't know. We'll see.
Yeah. I mean, it kind of stinks that there's, like, some of the stuff has been spurled pretty well. Like, I mean, you can just watch this season and tell at some point Lauren's taking over as Canary.
Yeah.
You know, it's pretty obvious. I don't think I'm really spoiling anything for you there. And the costume's already been leaked, so there's no question that.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, well, she's going to be Black Canary.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, I didn't need to know that.
Sorry.
God damn.
Sorry. Oh, Genie? Spurlers. I kid.
I'll just keep that under my hat.
Yeah, you should, because it would. Anyway. Because
it's funny.
Yeah. And again, it's such an obvious thing. I mean, if you don't see it coming, you really weren't paying attention. Because they kind of beat you over the head with it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And I think where you're at, if I believe right, I think it's... I think they really beat you over the head with it in the next few episodes. So keep your... you might not... You know, make sure you're not watching it live. Make sure you have a way of, you know, fast-forwarding.
Yeah, right, no, naturally.
I kid. All right, so let's see. Oh, I guess we should maybe talk about... this isn't that big of a story, but some trailer was released for Star Wars.
A Star what?
It's some movie. I think it's the one with, like, Spock and stuff, like Star Treks or something, where they...
Oh, no, you're thinking Battlestar Trek Galactica.
Trek Galactica. Yeah, so the internet pretty much, like, almost obliterated itself. Was that yesterday, I think, is when this dropped?
Right.
There's a trailer available for, what's it called? The Force Awakens?
The Force Awakens.
That name sure is still, it's just not awakening me, I'll tell you that.
No.
What'd you think of the trailer?
It looked like a pretty cool trailer. Yeah. I have no idea why the Dark Jedi's lightsaber has a hilt.
Why it's a cross? Yeah.
Yeah, why it's got a lightsaber hilt?
Yeah.
That doesn't make much sense to me.
The only thing I can think of is so you can look cool and light a cigar at the same time.
That would be cool.
Right? Because you got it all up like this, and, you know, the one's kicking back a little bit, and you just, like, put a cigar. I don't think that's what they're going to use it for, though.
Yeah, but I mean...
At least, like, Darth Maul, when you saw that double dong that he was using, you know, you were like, hey, you know?
Yeah, I'm not... Yeah.
Like, this is badass.
Like, the saber ignites, and then the little, like, sideburners kick on.
Yeah. Like, was he making creme brulee?
Yeah, exactly. Like, what is he doing? What if his hand's too far north on the saber?
Oh, that's a mess.
You're bumming.
Yeah, you better hope you don't get that thing turned sideways in the holster or something.
But I don't know.
Other than that, it looks pretty much like a Star Wars movie, right?
Or not interesting. It was cool to see the Millennium Falcon. And
yeah, in daytime, too. That was kind of odd. Like, not in space.
It's good to see the stormtroopers are diversifying a little.
We ain't found shit. Yeah. I agree. That was the first thought I had, too. Because that's, like, the very first scene in the trailer. Showing it's an African... Well, I was going to say African-American, but that's not true because whatever planet he's from, I don't know. Those people. I don't know. No. That's horrible.
Because here's my thing. Because, like I told you, when you were like, did you see the trailer? I thought it was a fake because of the comments I read on Reddit.
Yes.
So when the dude ripped his helmet off for, like, a millisecond, I'm like, this is Key and Peele.
That would have been hilarious. So something they would do, too.
I know. I was like, oh, no, it's not. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, like I said, other than the new lightsaber, I was kind of like, he looks like a Star Wars movie.
Yeah.
I mean, the soccer ball with the R2 head was kind of funny.
Right. Yeah.
I've already seen a shit ton of memes for it with the, you know, they see me rolling, you know.
Well, of course. Why wouldn't they? Yeah, dumb internet. God damn it.
Which, you know, the first couple times I saw it, I laughed at. And yeah, I think I'm about done laughing at that meme. But that's about it, though. There was nothing that I was like, oh, my God, at this one. Like, the last time, like, when the prequels came out, that very first one when you got that first look at Darth Maul.
Right.
Or when you saw his lightsaber for the first time. You know? You were like, holy shit, you know? I don't think the cross lightsaber really does a lot for me.
No, it doesn't do a whole lot for me either.
Yeah, and I'm with you. I'm still not understanding why you would have the little torches on the side.
I mean, I guess unless, you know, it's to keep someone else's lightsaber from sliding down and, like, a classic hand guard, you know?
I guess. On a sword. You know, what I kind of want to see is I'd like to see somebody who's, like, a Jedi have, like, the same one.
Right.
That way, at least you could go, okay, well, they're similar builds or something, but each lightsaber's individual.
Yeah.
You know, from what we've been told before, right?
Now, here's what I want to see. I want to see...
Double dong.
Some guy ignite his lightsaber, and the lightsaber goes up, and then he gets, like, a lightsaber, like, basket hilt around his hand, like he's in the Three Musketeers.
Ooh, I like that.
See, now we're talking.
That's nice. Then maybe, like,
punch somebody in the face, and he just, like, cuts their face in a million little pieces.
It'd be like a potato masher kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah.
That's a good idea. I like that. In fact, that's what my lightsaber is going to be, a potato masher. I'm just going to fuck it. I'm going to use it like it's a bludgeon, though, and just...
Oh, I was picturing like lightsaber gauntlets, but you mean like a big potato masher, yeah. Like a comically oversized lightsaber potato masher. Yeah. Okay, that's cool.
So if I need to cook, I'm all set. I can, you know, go ahead and hit up that mash real quick. I mean, I got to be careful. I can't hit the bottom of the pan. But,
yeah,
you
don't
know.
Go through the pan.
Right. But other than that, you know.
Until my, you know, patented lightsaber pan comes out.
Right, right. Patent pending.
Just bounce off of it.
Right. The old nonstick, yeah,
yeah.
Because otherwise, I'm just running around like I'm like some savage Viking guy or something. I'm just, you know, basically like if I just had a big pointy stick,
a big two-handed potato masher.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like the hammer from Braveheart.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, I mean, I can swing it overhand because, you know, I mean, it's still a lightsaber. It's still going to cut through things.
That's true.
But, you know, I prefer to just go full force and just, you know. Put all that force into one spot.
Potato mash people.
Yeah. And naturally, I'm going to have, you know, my arch nemesis will be some character that's got, like, slight burn marks on their face where I almost got them, but not quite all the way, you know. Right. Or, like, half of their face is, like, looking like it's the beginnings of the mash.
Some sort of weird alien planet where they're potato people.
Yes, Mr. Potato Heads are.
Yes.
I'm unstoppable on that planet.
You just rule with an iron fist.
I do. Like, they don't even question anything I say because they know that at any time they're mashed.
You've got giant vats like with bubbling gravy and stuff.
Hot butter and bubbling gravy. Yeah.
Chives ready to go.
Of course, yeah. And some garlic ready to go, you know. I'm all set. Some bacon, some bacon grease and bacon.
Well, I'm still thinking that's a great idea.
Because callback.
Yeah.
All right, so, yeah, you got anything else on the Star Wars thing, or are you ready to move?
Nah, I'm ready to go. I'm ready to move on. I need to see more before I can really get into it.
All right, yeah, I'm with you on that, too. And, again, we both said before that we're both real apprehensive about getting too excited. Plus, it's a year down the road.
Yeah, it's a ways away.
Like our pal Eric, you know, mentioned earlier, you know, at least in the meantime, we've got Ant-Man and Age of Ultron coming out. So
yeah,
you know,
for sure.
And I'm more excited about that because they're closer.
Right.
We'll see. Something trailer.
Yeah, like your something turkey, by the way. I forgot to.
Right.
I didn't respond because I think it was part of that group text.
Right. Yeah.
Which, by the way, fuck group text.
Yeah. That was, you noticed there was only two things I said. One was, you know, commenting after someone misspelled my name, and the other was just the something turkey.
Because I saw that, I was like, that's funny. And I pulled it up because I was going to respond. I saw I was in the group, and I'm like, nope, I'm not. Right. I don't want to get involved with this.
I understand.
Especially when, because I was part of two different group texts for some reason.
Yeah, that'll happen.
And in one of them, ladies, people started making plans about what they were doing on their own. I'm like, can't you just fucking text each other?
Yeah, right? That's what always happens, whether it's in the group text or it's on the, you know, Facebook where there's like the group whatnot. It's like people, it always devolves into like one or two conversations. And it's like, how about you move into something that's private?
Yeah, exactly.
You know?
I should have just started, like, throwing in, like, horrific pictures from the internet.
Well, that is usually what you and I do, is we try to take over a thread once it gets out of hand. Like, when it gets annoying, you and I plenty of times have just gone on and just inane things.
I should have thrown it, since it was Thanksgiving, that picture of the, you know, like, the guy with the turkey drawn on paper of someone's balls hanging through underneath the neck. Does it make the turkey neck?
I agree.
But, you know, that'd probably open up even more doors I want nothing to do with.
That's probably true, because somebody will probably be like, those are my balls. And
I'm offended by this.
Oh, that's the worst thing that they could say, though, because, again, as we learned last week, when someone goes, you're so mean, both of us are like fist pumping, you know?
Yeah, it's true. Like, huzzah.
Yeah, so you do. I'm so offended. Be like, good.
Like, oh, yeah? Wait till you see this picture.
Like, really? I haven't even gotten warmed up yet. Like, we used to tell people different times when they're, you know, they'd say something about how they were offensive or whatever, and we'd know them and be like, no. It's like, come on. It's like, you're like PG. We started R here.
Let's, yeah, for sure.
Let's amp it up. You don't even cuss enough to get a PG-13 rating, let alone an R. And we get a hard R.
Every time. Yeah.
We get the hard R, she gets the hard D. That's awful. All right, so let's move on.
All right.
Let's talk some funny books here and close that out.
Okay.
You said you didn't read a whole lot this week, so.
I.
Well, real quick, did you read anything new this week? Like,
no.
No, okay.
I read nothing new.
All right, well, let me recap the new stuff I did, and then we can go into the archives, if you will.
Okay.
I read Rasputin number 2, and normally I read, like, as much as I can, and this week it just wasn't going to happen. So next week I'll try to get something together. Anywho. I read Rasputin number 2, which is a good continuation of the first
now,
one.
While you're reading Rasputin,
I'm beating
you
off,
should
yes.
be drinking Rasputin Russian Stout.
Oh.
Just saying.
Oh.
Old Rasputin's pretty delicious.
All right. Does it have a big dick?
If you drink it, you'll achieve one, because it's a very manly stout.
I see. Not that you would know, Mr. Pinterest. Anyway. I got to remember to write a note to encourage people to blister your bottom about Pinterest.
I fully expected, you know.
Yeah, it's fine.
Yeah.
This feels
Trial
like a week
fire.
We should. This feels like a good week for a Growler Thursday, then. No. let's see. You know, again, though, Rasputin, you remember last week or last time I was like, you know, it felt like it ended before it was done. Like, it didn't feel like an endpoint, and it was just, that's it, and then it's just ads. Same thing in this issue. Like, it just doesn't feel like it kind of hits a wrap point. There's no, like, continued or anything at the bottom of it. It's just things happen, and then you go to the next page, and it's like, all right, I guess it's over. Because there's,
so
like,
I'm
five
done
pages.
Reading now.
Yeah, 5 pages of, you know, here's all the other new books coming out. Which isn't a big deal, but it's just, it's so odd. It's like I said, most books say, you know, continued or to be continued or more or, you know, same bat time, same bat channel, whatever. I also read Odyssey number 1 from Matt Fraction, and I forgot to write down the artist's name. And
is it worth reading?
Yes. Originally, I guess it started because I read, you know, because it's Fraction, and he has his little bit at the end of the book because they don't have a letters page just yet. But when they do, I'm sure I'll read it because he's one of those that full on embraces his weirdness and fans. But he talks about how originally he was kind of just wanting to do like a retelling of the Odyssey, but with mainly female characters. And he wanted this to kind of be like his version of Barbarella.
Oh, all right.
So I was like, okay, you know, makes sense. Oddly enough, I believe his wife, Kelly DeConnick, I think's her name. I think she did the English translation for the Barbarella comic just recently.
That's weird.
Anyway, yeah, so it was a pretty interesting book. I mean, there's tons of women in it because that's the way the theme of the book's going to be. But it's got, like, you know, the different gods and stuff. And, you know, if you've read the Odyssey and are familiar with that storyline, you won't feel alienated by this a whole lot. If you have no idea what the Odyssey is, shame on your educational system. And second of all, go read that. But
yeah, it's not a Honda. Dicks.
True. And third of all, yeah, but you know, but yeah, it's one of those books I'll definitely go more issues on because I think it's going to take a few issues to kind of really set itself up,
right?
You know, so there you go. That's all I read this week. Unfortunately, I wanted to read Arkham Manor number 2 and Superior Iron Man number 2 came out, and there's some other books that, you know. Oh, was it Gotham by Midnight, I think it was, and I really wanted to check that out, but I didn't have a chance before we recorded.
Well, so, you know, turkey and stuff.
Something turkey, right?
Yeah, something turkey.
Which is, is going to go up too far past Thanksgiving, or that would have probably just been the show name.
That would have been perfect.
Yeah,
but
too far gone.
Yeah. No, I read a little of the Punisher Now series, the newest, you know, incarnation or whatever.
Right.
Yeah, it's all right.
Not really feeling.
You know, I mean, Punisher's always got a special little spot in my heart.
Right. That's cholesterol, Tony. That's not the Punisher.
No, I thought it was the him trying to shoot his way out of my chest.
Well, kind of.
But, yeah, I mean, it's not bad, but it's, I mean, you know, the last real Punisher stuff I read was the Garth Ennis stuff.
Oh, that was good. Well, so, I guess it depends on where, because Garth Ennis, I think, had, like, a really good run, then an eh run, and then another really good run, from what I understand.
Fair enough.
So, yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, I might check it out.
These are from, like, 2014, right?
Yes.
Okay,
yeah.
So, like, the brand newest.
The newest run.
Marvel Now. And okay, so it's written by Nathan Edmondson and illustrated by Mitch Gerads? Gerads? I don't know how you say his name. Where he moves to L.A. following a drug trial?
Yes. It's interesting because they're definitely angling towards, like, it seems like a new Punisher maybe. Like a lady Punisher.
Really?
Yeah, because there's a cop in it that he...
I just had one of those added to the Hobo Canyon, actually.
Lady Punisher? Yeah.
The hobo special jokes order. Are not going to stop. 2014, the year of the hobo.
The year of the hobo. What's your Chinese zodiac, hobo? Huh. That explains the shit stains.
Yeah, it does.
I don't know. Like, so I'll check it out for a little bit, but it's, you know, it's just there.
You know what? When you and I were talking about Punisher storylines and stuff, I think the ones that I had read that were maybe some of the really good ones were from 2011, because it looks like Greg Rucka wrote it, because it took over from, let's see, according to Wikipedia here, continues the tradition of Matt Fraction's War Journal series and Rick Remender's previous Punisher series, because I think I remember that Remender did a pretty good run on it, and then Rucka, I mean, it's Greg Rucka, who's usually, you know, the motherfucking Rucka, he's usually pretty strong. So maybe it was those that are, maybe those are the better ones. I don't know. If anyone listens and can help us out, such as folks that we know that run comic book podcasts, graphic novice.
Yeah, comic rose.
7 days yeah. A geek.
Throw me a bone.
What, yeah. You know
what books are supposed to read, yo?
Also that, yeah. If anybody who listens to the show has any recommendations for us to read that we don't talk about, go for it. There are a lot of books I read that I don't talk about, because most of the time they fall into my, they were just the regular book where, you know, the story progressed, no big deal. Yeah.
Yeah.
Which tend to mostly be the big two companies.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, if you're reading Spider-Man, generally nothing groundbreaking is happening. It's pretty much, it's just Spider-Man, another issue, move forward, you know.
Right.
And that's why I tend to go to these other books like, you know, Rasputin and Odyssey, and they're a little bit.
Something different?
A little different, yeah.
Little, yellow, different.
Right. Or I started reading Manifest Destiny last night.
Right.
Which I've been wanting to read for a long time. Do you know the story behind that?
Mm-mm.
It's Lewis and Clark out on their, you know, exploring of the Louisiana Purchase.
Yeah, getting some of that sweet squaw poontang.
Well, this story's not quite that.
Oh, okay.
What it is, though, is they're like going through the forest and stuff, and then all of a sudden they get basically attacked by what they can't classify, because it's not quite a centaur and it's not quite a minotaur, because it's got a buffalo head, human torso, and then like horse body or buffalo body, I don't remember. So they can't quite, anyway, so you know,
so it's man in a buffalo.
Yeah, literally, right. it's an interesting read, though. And then there's kind of like a zombie element to it, but they're not zombies. So, but it's been pretty good. I read 4 issues of it last night, and right. I've been reading, like, I don't know how many people I've seen recommend it or heard on different podcasts recommend it. And I was like, God damn it. I have it. I just need to read it, you know?
Right.
So I finally gave it a go last night, and that one, it's a pretty strong read so far. And then I got caught all the way up on Trees, which
Trees. Okay.
Yeah. Which
you're talking about, like, r/trees, right, bro?
No.
No.
God damn it. I'm going to feel really bad about this, too, because this is a book that's written by a fucking big-name writer, and I can't think of who it is. Hold on. I'm pulling this up here.
It's probably Tommy Chong, bro.
Tony, entertain the fans.
Me and all my ants out there.
Oh, Warren Ellis is the writer on it. Jason Howard is the artist.
That's a fine, he's got a fine beard, that Warren Ellis.
Right, and like I said, he's a big name guy, and I couldn't think of his name because Morrison kept popping into my head, and I'm like, get out of my head, Jim. I don't want to talk about the Doors right now. Even if you are the Lizard King. You know the... Oh, anyway. Oh, shit. it's kind of a weird book, but I've really enjoyed it. Like, as it's gone on more and more, I've, like, really enjoyed it. And again, I think you got to be a fan of Ellis, you know? I think it's one of those things. It's kind of like, again, I always go back to, like, there's just some comic writers that you either really like their work or you don't. I don't know. I think Ellis and Morrison kind of fall into those categories where there's not a great... Garth Ennis fell in that, too.
Right.
That there's not really that middle ground so much. You know, you either loved Breacher or you didn't. And if you didn't, then...
You're a goddamn fool.
All I can hope for is that the Allfather falls on you.
Nice.
That's only funny if you've read the book. Yeah. Which, if you haven't, why the hell haven't you read Preacher?
All right, finish this podcast and then go read Preacher.
And then go listen to the Art of Wrestling CM Punk interview.
Yeah. And then go download all of our back episodes.
And then listen to all of our podcasts.
Yes.
And then... Anyway, we'll get to the other part. So yeah, that's about all I think I've read a couple other things, but nothing really standing out to me other than that this, you know, recently.
Right.
Anything else you got for the funny books?
Not really.
Maybe
I'm
shortest.
I'm kind of like in a desert of funny books this week. You know?
I see.
My lips are all chapped. I'm wandering. I'm eating sand cookies.
Speaking of.
Or pumpkin pie from Smucker's.
Speaking of like a wasteland and chapped lips and whatnot, did you see the like rumor or confirmed, I don't know if it's been confirmed yet, that McConaughey might be playing Randall Flagg in the Stand movie?
Really?
Yeah.
No, I had not heard that.
Yeah, there's a lot of people that hate that and a lot of people that really dug it. I don't really know where I fall in that.
I think I can see it after his, you know,
True Detective role.
Yeah. Run. Yeah.
Yeah. Because if he hadn't done True Detective, I'd be like, you know?
Yeah. If like, it's not that, it's all, you know.
This isn't a rom-com.
I get older, they stay the same age.
Listen, I'd be okay.
All right.
Now tell me if he plays a role like that, that Randall Flagg wouldn't be super creepy.
It would be.
Right? I mean, on top of just
Randall Flagg's just in the statutory rape.
Right. Just instead of just being evil, he's also a fucking, like, you know, a raper of children.
Yeah. A pedophile.
Yeah. Like, oh my God, this guy's terrible.
All right.
Yeah. So, anyway, that's it. I didn't want to spend a lot of time on that. I just didn't know if you saw it.
No, I had not seen that.
Okay, so what do we got here? Do you want to do Shut Up and Take My Money next, or do you want to do Feetsball?
We should probably do Feetsball.
Yeah, we got a lot of Feetsball. We might have to push the Shut Up and Take My Money back, because we're almost to 2 hours. So
really?
Yeah.
Oh, I really got to cover Shut Up and Take My
Money.
Okay,
then we'll cover it, too. We're just going to go long again. Long, and we're strong, we're going to get our friction on.
We'll just plow through the football right quick.
We have like 100 games to go through.
Well, here's only three this
here
week.
Real quick. Here's how we'll do it. I'm not going to tell you what the games were. All you need to know is this. Tony was 100% on the week correct. I got 5 out of 6. So overall, we fucking crushed it.
Oh, yeah. People should take our advice.
And I do have to give props where props are due. Tony almost dead on nailed the score of the Chicago Bears-Detroit Lions game.
I knew that was going to be a shit show.
Yeah, it was so close. I really, the way the game started, I really didn't think it. I thought it was going to be the opposite.
I know. I saw the same thing. I'm like, God damn it. They're going to fuck me when I didn't call them.
Now, see, you shouldn't have been that way. You should have been like, my team's winning. Woo!
And, well, yeah, but, you know, I like being right, too.
Like, I'll tell you this. Detroit is playing much better football this year than they have in a while, right?
Right.
My brother gets over to my sister's house on Thanksgiving, tries to look at the score, but they cut away to a commercial at that point. And I'm like, you don't want to know what the score is if you're a Lions fan. And he's like, why? And I was like, oh, it's 14-3 Bears. And he's like, it's early. And I'm like, no, as a Lions fan, it's late. And I even said right then, I was like, all I can hope for is Jay Cutler will turn the ball over.
Oh, boy, did he.
Well, he turned it over twice, and one of them was like a Hail Mary at the very end of the game. Like, he shouldn't even been throwing that ball at the end of the game.
Yeah, but, you know, he needs to stop thinking about the cutlet and think about getting balls to his receivers.
The cutlet. Good call. All I can say is, you know, yeah, Lions.
Oh, Hoodie's up. It's getting chilly in the house.
I don't have a hoodie to put on. Well, I have one behind me. Okay, so that brings our record dead even. You and I are at 15-9 for the picks that we made.
What am I doing here? Jesus Christ.
Yeah, you're right. Well, we weren't really talking it yet.
We're about ready to.
Now, lace up them cleats.
Lace them up.
Put
charging down the gridiron. Champions of the turf.
Strap up your chin straps.
The sexiest football picks in the network.
Thursday night football. We've got the Dallas Football Cowboys, America's team, at Tony's Chicago Bears.
My Chicago Bears, Brian?
Yeah, unless you are tired of owning them.
God damn it, Brian. My Bears are going to pull off a victory here against all odds after coming off a loss.
Well, both teams are.
In the snowy fields of Soldier.
On Robbie Gould's foot, probably, right?
Exactly. Yeah. 24-21 off of Robbie Gould's foot.
You know, it was interesting. They showed a stat yesterday. I didn't realize that in, like, was it the last three games, I think it was, he'd only kicked, like, two field goals. Two of the games, he didn't even attempt one.
Right.
I was like, oh, my God, when the Lions were at their worst, even Jason Hansen always seemed to get one attempt, you know?
Yeah,
and that's why he was the MVP, even when Barry Sanders was there. Yeah, you know, Chicago didn't allow Detroit to do much running yesterday. They do seem to be pretty aggressive against the run, and that's where Dallas is at their best. And Dallas was terrible yesterday against the team they played that I can't remember. So,
not America's team.
Oh, Philly. That's who it was.
All right.
So, I actually, it's real hard to pick the Bears, though. What the hell? This one's for Tony. I'll take the Bears in this one, too. 24 for the Bears. I'm going to say 21 for the Cowboys.
Oh, we got matching scores, Brian.
Yeah.
That means it is officially a...
no chance in hell it wins, right?
Lock of the week.
You need to have the McMahon no chance so that when we joke, we have it set up.
You're probably right.
Because given the way we pick. All right, so Sunday night. We have the New England Patriots, fresh off their prompt spanking of my Detroit Lions, playing against the San Diego Superchargers.
I must have wrote down the wrong game.
What do you have written down?
Broncos Chiefs?
I don't think so. Let's double check.
Well, that's this weekend's games. Right?
Yeah.
Broncos Chiefs Sunday?
Maybe I fucked up. That's possible. If so, this is a great part of the show.
We're on top of things.
You know what? I bet you're right. I bet you're right. Because I bet I wrote down the Thursday game, and then I went on to the games that week instead of this week. You're
son
right.
Son of a bitch.
Yeah. Because this is week, what, 13?
Yes.
Yeah. You're right. My bad.
Broncos Chiefs, Brian.
Man, I just gave you
Sunday night football.
I just gave you a little taste of next week's games or game.
Which, in my opinion, it's got to be game of the week.
Broncos Chiefs? That's for the division pretty much right now.
Yeah, pretty
it's
much.
It's a big game. Faux show.
Broncos at Chiefs. What are you thinking?
Playing in Kansas City, huh?
Yep.
I'll tell you, the Broncos' defense has not been great the last few weeks. I mean, they let Miami put, 34 on them?
Mm-hmm.
And there's that Jamal Charles kid on the Chiefs, who I've heard is decent.
Some say.
I'm going to take the Broncos only for one reason, and that's because the Chiefs fucking lost to the Raiders. So
that's a fine reason.
At some point. Anyway, I'm going to take the Broncos. I'm going to say 30 for the Broncos to 21 for the Chiefs. I think this is going to be not a whooping, but maybe.
I also think it's going to be a close game, but I'm going Chiefs over Broncos.
Ooh.
30-27.
Oh, I see. You about flipping the script on me, huh?
For sure.
I see how it is. You son of a...
Now, for the Monday night game, we also have probably the second most exciting game.
We have the Miami Fish at the New York Jets, 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 Jets.
This is going to be a barnstormer.
If you're a Dolphins fan, I think.
Yeah, pretty much.
I'm giving the the Jets. Absolutely no chance in hell on this one.
What do you mean?
Which means they're probably going to somehow squeak this one out because that's how I'm going to say Miami's going to put up 30 and the Jets are going to put up 3. I'm going to fucking call just a blowout.
Wow, 33.
And the Jets don't have anything on offense that screams better than what the Dolphins have on defense to me, you know?
Now, I've kind of got the same idea here.
Not to mention, I watched the Dolphins pretty much shut down the Lions. So,
right.
You know.
I'm doing Dolphins 17.
Mm-hmm.
Jets 9. They're not scoring a touchdown. It's
yeah,
all field
that was
goals.
Like I wanted to put 10, and I didn't think about maybe going 6 or 9 or something like that because it's like I just don't think they're going to score a touchdown on them.
Yeah, they're not scoring a touchdown.
Yeah. So I decided that if we do this again next year
yes.
and we get other people involved,
uh-huh.
that part of the tiebreaker is going to be, since we're picking the scores, is if you get the score right, or maybe we'll do it within a couple points, or we'll figure something like that out to where you get like an extra point or something. If you're like one extra point, if you're like real close, and like 2 if you're spot on or something, or 3 if you're dead on with it.
Right.
You know, something a little extra.
Extra?
So, yeah, that's the football picks for the week.
That's the football picks of the week.
Still feeling all fired up. I kind of want to go run through a brick wall now.
I know. I tell you.
No, I don't anymore.
Moments passed.
Yeah. All right. So, let's do the shut up and take my money.
Shut up and take my money.
Boom. What you got?
This I got in an email today.
Okay.
And it's sold out, so you can't even get it anymore. That's how exclusive it was.
Right. Right. Please tell me you got one before it sold out.
No, I didn't.
I don't even know what it is anyway.
It was an email from Cards Against Humanity.
Oh, okay.
And it said on Black Friday, they were having their Black Friday shitstorm.
Yeah.
Where you can buy their new shit.
Right.
So I'm like, okay. So I clicked on the thing. And it said right on the email, to bring you all the savings of Black Friday, they completely removed Cards Against Humanity from their store. So you could only buy the new shit.
Wow.
Right?
All right.
And what they were selling today was a box of bullshit.
Right.
Says, don't miss this once-in-a-lifetime offer. Today only. Literal feces from an actual bull. Looks, smells, and tastes like shit. Because it is. Hand-packaged inside a custom bullshit box. Fertilize your garden or adorn a festive tree or surprise with a gift of poop. Yeah. I mean, it's Cards Against Humanity. I love those guys.
Yeah.
I think it's their way of saying, like it says, all the poop is gone. You bought all of it. Experience the ultimate savings this Black Friday by purchasing nothing.
Wow. I like that. Because I like that they didn't even throw anything else up, you know, or that wasn't like a joke thing. And like an hour later, they put up like, you know, the normal sets for, you know, 30% off or something, you know.
Right. Oh, God damn it. They changed it already. Earlier I clicked under FAQ and it was all regarding the bullshit box.
Oh.
And it was hilarious. And I just clicked on it again and I should have kept it up because they changed it.
Well, either that or lesson for next year screenshot.
Yeah.
Something like that. Yeah.
Like one of the FAQs was, is it legal to mail shit? And it's like only one way to find out.
Well, we know it is because we talked about on Shut Up and Take My Money before we talked about mailing various animals' feces to people.
Yes.
Which I couldn't tell you the name of the site anymore, but it's, you know. I remember us discussing the merits of, or, you know, like, if we could afford sending shit to people.
Yeah, it was various animal shits
yes,
from that
yes.
website.
And various costs based on, yeah. That seems
so,
fair,
yeah.
Right?
I mean, there you go. Unfortunately, they're sold out, so you can't buy any more shit. But I just, I really feel like they were just like, fuck you, Black Friday.
Yeah, that's...
Here's what we do.
I'm guessing that's what it is. And it's funny because... You know,
people bought it, too.
Yeah. Well, and they really could have done something for Black Friday, you know?
Oh, for sure. Well, that's why when I saw you can, like, get our new shit, I was like, oh, shit, maybe, because I know there's a new expansion out. Maybe it's, you know, I was like, oh, cool, maybe I can get it on the cheap.
Nope.
So I clicked the email.
Nope, you get nothing cheap.
Nope, I could have bought somebody a box of shit.
I can't think of anybody that I really want to give a box of shit to. Don't get me wrong. I could give one to you.
Right.
But it's just... Your reaction will be fine and all, but it's just not the same. You know what I mean? It's like you want to give that to somebody that's going to be offended by it kind of a thing.
Yeah.
Like, not somebody that is going to have a good giggle at it, you know?
Well, and if you, because they have a picture of a box, you wouldn't know what it is. Because it just says bullshit by Cards Against Humanity. It's a black box with a little white smiley face turd on the side. So you wouldn't really know what it is if you weren't in the know.
Right, that'd be great. Someone's like, oh, you got me Cards Against Humanity. Yes, I certainly did.
Ah, good times.
Yep, yep. Well, I guess, I mean, if you still want to find, you know, a way to sell or send animal feces to someone, you could probably comb our archives.
For sure.
Or probably Google search, but I would prefer you comb our archives.
And so would I.
I would just go back to episode one and just start from there. You'll find
right.
it. I can tell you one thing. Tate was on the episode, so it's going to have been within around, what was that, episode... I don't remember when she joined the show. I used to know the episode number. I can't remember now. It was a Halloween episode, what, 2 years ago? I want to say it was 2 years ago.
Maybe.
Anyway.
But yeah, so, this is officially a...
Shut up and take my money.
Yep. Well, they can't because they're sold out.
That's true.
You get nothing, sir, and you will like it.
Right.
Now is when you need the... Do you have the wah, 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 wah?
I don't have anything like that.
Sad trombone, nothing. Isn't sad trombone should be a staple on there because I'm part of the show.
Yeah, I had it. What happened to it?
Ah, jeez.
Wow.
Probably a masturbating mix-up.
Probably.
Beating your dick on the board again.
I mean, I guess I got this.
Oh, good for you.
That'll work, I guess. All right, so I also had a shut up and take my money, and this was not that I... Not that I truly advocate buying these, but I sent you the link to it, Tony.
Yeah, I'm looking at it right now.
So it's the Minisuit Selfie Stick Pro with built-in remote on handle for GoPro, Apple, and Android devices. And it is literally an extender stick that you put your phone on so that you can take, like, extreme, like, 3.5 foot away selfies or upskirts or under bathroom stalls.
Now, I'll be honest. I've never seen one as Bluetooth, I guess.
Yeah.
But I've been eyeballing one of these for my GoPro.
Well, naturally, creepy Uncle Tony. You
know, well, I wasn't thinking of that, but now I am.
Yeah.
But,
oh, yeah, this is going to be good.
Yeah, see, but yeah, I don't know. What's with the Bluetooth? Does it have, like, controls? Is that what it is?
Yeah, there's actually a remote, I think, is what it is. I think that's what, yeah, Bluetooth remote for iPhone, Android, or whatever. Yeah, no app download needed. Just use Bluetooth.
Oh, see, remote function. Not compatible with GoPro. I am not interested in this product.
Why wouldn't it be? GoPro probably just doesn't have
GoPro
it.
GoPro is Bluetooth enabled.
Yeah, that's probably why.
So, yeah.
But either
at least
way.
Mine isn't.
How the hell are you going to take the picture with the GoPro then? Or you
just
shoot
do a video?
Yeah.
And then screen cap it.
Yeah, that'll work.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that was. I saw this a couple of days ago, and I was just like, wow, the creep is strong in this one. Because I get what they're saying, but it's just one of those things. It just reminds you of, like, Tinder trying to sell you that they're a dating site. Yeah. Or an app, I mean, you know? It's like, listen, I get it could be used for that.
Well, let me see some of the reviews here.
Come on.
Come on, you son of a bitch.
Okay.
Good to see my... top-notch internet out here in the sticks is working amazing. Not opening this link for me.
Yeah, those rabbits running that cable for you.
Jesus Christ. Okay, well, I was going to look at the reviews, but it's not loading, so I'm going to nix that.
What is it you wanted to look at the reviews?
I was just curious. It's a very highly reviewed. I mean, it's like 42 people, and it's got 4.5 stars.
One of the reviews is 1 star. It says, if you need this, you need to reevaluate your life choices.
That's pretty funny.
Saw a guy using one of these. He looked like a complete douche. Yeah, most of them, it's just like, this is awesome. Love it. Good.
Like I said, I mean, I could see if you're...
Hilarious. This product eliminates the fact that sometimes you need to ask a stranger to take pictures of you and your family.
Well, see, I could see more like... Because I'm talking about when we get snow this year, I already told kids, when we get snow, we're taking a GoPro and we're going sledding.
Nice.
You know? And I could see having like a handle you can stick the thing out when you're going on the hill.
Right.
Like, you get a cool picture out of
sure.
it.
Sure. You know, but, or if you're somewhere that, you know, there's assholes with like signs or something, you can like, you know... Hold it up above them, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah, and, you know, the old changing room doors, you go right over them.
Yeah, That's why I ordered one.
I mean,
whoops.
Yeah, I don't know.
It just cracks me up because, like I said, it just, I forgot what site I saw this on. And, you know, of course, because it's the internet, they were pretty much just like, yeah, right. Like, who's not using this for creeps, you know, and creeping?
Yeah, for sure.
I was like, yeah. Like, even if it wasn't your intention, at some point you're going to have the thought going, you know.
I could definitely.
That's so awful. So awful. But, yeah, so that's what I got. And these are, you know, a low 1995.
It's not bad.
Free shipping.
Shut up and take my money.
And even better, available on Amazon.com. After you go to saltylanguage.com.
Saltylanguage.com.
Yep. Click on the banner.
And if you like Star Wars, click the ThinkGeek link and go buy some Star Wars shit on ThinkGeek through our website.
Well, if they still have them, I haven't looked in a while. Like the lightsaber popsicle sticks that we talked about on the show
before. The Sith or Jedi bathrobes.
Yep.
Pretty awesome.
I think they have like some of the like superhero pajamas and whatnot on that site. All sorts of fun on there.
Or if you really want to be awesome, just become a Patreon sponsor.
Hey!
Join the few, the proud, the enthusiasts.
I kind of want that on a shirt now. Like, that seems like a good idea. Yeah, and all the... Wow, all of a sudden I have no voice. Those are all available, or the links are available to those on the right-hand side of the page? Or,
yes, sir.
Okay. You know, while you're on the website... Check out the banners at the very top for the networks we're part of, such as the Pod Gods Network and Musings of a Geek Network, as well as we're on the directory for the Geek Life Radio .com page.
Right.
And yeah. So check out the shows on those networks because there's some, you know,
killer shows.
Some old right shows on there. I mean,
right.
Right. You know, Kyle's right. At. You know what? I was gonna start just doing some shout outs and I'm just totally blanking. God, ridiculous like ramblings. Go,
Daft Pod.
Yeah, Green Up
Little
Gaming.
Punch Drunk. Green Up.
Yep. Doing the job I mentioned earlier.
There you go, doing the job.
Hey.
The Barker Podcast Circle Jerk Collection.
Now. They don't always circle up.
Not all. They're not always.
Well, they're in England. You know, they do other stuff. You know,
I don't know.
Maybe that's do things differently there.
Shagging and whatnot.
Right. Right.
Of course, a little punch drunk. 7 days of geek. If they're by the time this comes up,
it'll be over.
3 days of podcasting will be over.
Well, I mean, they're still available though. They just put out 30 days worth of podcasts.
Yeah,
so
it'll be back to one a week or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Be back to reality. Hope there goes gravity. Let's see. Anybody else we want to yell out? I feel like we're going to forget somebody and then feel bad.
Go Ida Heno on the Twitters.
Yeah, you didn't mention his podcast. Yeah.
And, you know, and his want and need of wrestling stuff.
Right.
The Comic Roast, they're supporters.
Yep. And Decent Chaps overall, the Graphic Novice podcast.
The Geek Dig podcast, which I swear I'm listening to by next week. Because once the weekend hits, I don't listen to podcasts.
Right. Nothing but hardcore porn from that on.
Exactly.
As soon as he gets off of work.
It's nothing but ball slapping. All it is.
That's the weirdest Sirius channel I've ever heard, by the way. It's just, you know.
Like, Sirius XM 83, ball slapping. That's all it is.
Yeah. Just hours of that. Just different types, though. I mean, it changes, so, you know. While you're on the Salty Language .com website, you can also pull up all the extra episodes that we've put out. Now will be 175 plus the enthusiast episode. Plus there's 1 week we put up two episodes in the same week. Is there any others I'm forgetting there?
But you know what's crazy about that episode? We put up two episodes? Or wasn't it just like part one and part two?
Yeah, yeah.
So it still haven't broke the numbering.
Right. So
not only are we the sexiest network on the
podcast. We're the sexiest network on the podcast.
That as well. I would like to say we're the most consistent.
Except for when it comes to funny.
Well, I mean, then we're just playing over the top.
I was waiting for you to say dominating, but all right. Let's see. Anything else on the website people can do? Oh, Tony will put up links and various pictures of him and under things.
Yep, you'll have that. Enjoy.
Again, they're Easter eggs. You have to hunt for them.
That's true. Click around.
One of these times, it really should put something weird in there just to see if anyone ever finds it.
But how would I know?
Yeah, maybe they mention it and put something really weird in there somewhere.
Yeah, maybe.
You know, something so odd that, you know, if someone found it, they'd be, like, scarred for life. Yet still able to get on social media and let you know.
Like, forced to acknowledge the awfulness.
Right. Like, you know, put up something like, you know, I don't know, we don't have any prizes to give. But otherwise, it'd be like, you know, tell people if you find whatever on the website, you know, tell us where, and maybe you win a prize.
Maybe.
Maybe. Then they realize.
The full unpixelated picture.
Right. I was going to say a no prize, but, you know, that's good, too. So, yeah, so there's all that. So go to the website, just randomly click on there like you're just having spasms while you're using your mouse, you know? Something you click on will entertain you.
Or Parkinson's dick.
Or Parkinson's dick, right.
Naturally.
The old shaky groin. Shakiest dick in the West. Oh, man, now that's something we can all get behind.
Yes.
I don't want to be in front of it.
Probably say the same thing.
All right. Well, for this extended episode,
how
I guess.
How extended is it?
20 minutes. We went way over.
Well, let's keep going.
4 hours? All right. Let's go. By the end of it, we sound like Jerry Lewis at the end of the telethon. Come on, please.
They're going to kill me. Just kill me.
They won't let me eat until we hit our numbers. By the way, I don't run telethons anymore. Some weird legal thing. I don't know.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Sorry.
Lawyers.
Oh, yeah. You can find the show on the Twitters at salty_language. You can find me at Stunami.
I am at Monotony.
Occasionally.
Occasionally, yeah. Mm-hmm. Been less lately, but, you know, yeah. Whatever.
That'll happen. Right? How you like M apples?
Exactly.
So I guess with that, have beer, you'll be fine.
Stay salty.
And I don't know. I don't know. I don't want to tell them to go fuck themselves. You already did that. I can't say go stuff yourselves because I did that last week.
Okay.
Keep a smile on your face and keep laughter in your heart. Should I go with something like that?
Sure, why not?
Let's not. Let's just get the hell out of here.
Take two?
Yeah. No, this is the part where we say posse out and just leave.
All right, posse out.
You are now leading the world of Musings of a Geek Podcast Network. Stay geeky, my friends.